Thank you for listening to our audiobooks. We do our best to regularly upload quality books with clear narrations. Please subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell icon so we can bring you more great books. Thank you very much and enjoy your audiobook.
Welcome to the Audio Renaissance presentation of The Lord God Made Them All, written by James Herriot, produced from master recordings provided by Chivers Press Publishers Limited, production of this compilation supervised by Tony Hutz, and read by Christopher Timothy.
Chapter 1. When the gate fell on top of me, I knew I was really back home. My mind drifted effortlessly over my spell in the RAF to the last time I had visited the Ripleys. It was to nip some calves, as Mr. Ripley said over the phone, or more correctly, to emasculate them by means of the Verdizzo bloodless castrator, and when the message came in, I realized that a large part of my morning had gone. It was always something of a safari to visit Anson Hall, because the old house lay at the end of a ridged and rutted track, which twisted across the fields through no fewer than 7 gates. Gates are one of the curses of a country vet's life, and in the Yorkshire Dales, before the coming of the cattle grids, we suffered more than most. We were resigned to opening 2 or 3 on many of the farms, but 7 was a bit much. And at the Ripleys it wasn't just the number, but the character. The first one, which led off the narrow road, was reasonably normal, an ancient thing of rusty iron, and as I unlatched it, it did at least swing round, groaning on its hinges. It was the only one which swung. The others were of wood, and of the type known in the Dales as shoulder gates. I could see how they got their name as I hoisted each one up, balanced the top spar on my shoulder, and dragged it round. These had no hinges, but were tied at one end with binder twine, top and bottom. Even with an ordinary gate, there is a fair amount of work involved. You have to stop the car, get out, open the gate, drive through, stop the car again, dismount, and close the thing behind you. But the road to Anson Hall was hard labour. The gates deteriorated progressively as I approached the farm, and I was puffing with my efforts as I bumped and rattled my way up to number 7. This was the last and the most formidable, a malignant entity with a personality of its own. Over decades it had been patched and repaired with so many old timbers that probably none of the original structure remained. But it was dangerous. I got out of the car and advanced a few steps. We were old foes, this gate and I, and we faced each other for some moments in silence. We had fought several brisk rounds in the past, and there was no doubt the gate was ahead on points. The difficulty was that apart from its wobbly, loosely nailed eccentricity, it had only one string hinge halfway down. This enabled it to pivot on its frail axis with deadly effect. With the utmost care, I approached the right-hand side and began to unfasten the binder twine. The string, I noticed bitterly, was, like all the others, neatly tied in a bow. And as it fell clear, I grabbed hastily at the top spar, but I was too late. Like a live thing, the bottom rail swung in and rapped me cruelly on the shins. And as I tried to correct the balance, the top bashed my chest. It was the same as all the other times. As I hauled it round, an inch at a time, the gate buffeted me high and low. I was no match for it. Another thing which didn't help was that I could see Mr. Ripley watching me benevolently from the farmhouse doorway. While I wrestled the gate open, contented puffs rose from the farmer's pipe, and he did not stir from his position until I had hobbled over the last stretch of grass and stood before him.
"Now then, Mr. Herriot, you've come to nip me a few calves."
A smile of unaffected friendship creased the stubbled cheeks. Mr. Ripley shaved once a week, on market day. Considering, with some logic, that since only his wife and his cattle saw him on the other 6 days, there was no point in scraping away at his face every morning with a razor. I bent and massaged my bruised ankles. Mr. Ripley, that gate. It's a menace. Do you remember the last time I was here? You promised me faithfully you'd have it mended. In fact, you said you'd get a new one. It's about time, isn't it?
Aye, you're right, young man, Mr. Ripley said, nodding his head in profound agreement. I did say that, but I knows it's one of them little jobs which never seem to get done.
He chuckled ruefully, but his expression altered to concern when I wound up my trouser leg and revealed a long abrasion on my shin.
Eh, that's a shame. That settled it. There'll be a new gate on there by next week, I'll guarantee it.
But, Mr. Ripley, that's exactly what you said last time, when you saw the blood running down my knee. Those were your very words. You said you'd guarantee it.
I know.
The farmer tamped down the tobacco with his thumb and got his pipe going again to his satisfaction.
Me missus is allus on to me about me bad memory, but don't worry, Mr. Herriot, I've had me a lesson today. I'm right sorry about your leg, and that gate'll never bother you again. I guarantee it.
Okay, I said, and limped over to the car for the Badizzo. Where are the calves, anyway? Mr. Ripley crossed the farmyard unhurriedly and opened the half door on a loose box.
They're in there.
For a moment, I stood transfixed as a row of huge, shaggy heads regarded me impassively over the timbers. Then I extended a trembling finger. Do you mean those? The farmer nodded happily.
Aye, that's them.
I went forward and looked into the box. There were 8 strapping yearlings in there, some of them returning my stare with mild interest, others cavorting and kicking up their heels among the straw. I turned to the farmer. You've done it again, haven't you?
Eh?
You asked me to come and nip some calves. These aren't calves, they're bulls. And it was the same last time. Remember those monsters you had in the same box? I nearly ruptured myself closing the nippers, and you said you'd get them done at 3 months old in future. In fact, you said you'd guarantee it. The farmer nodded solemnly in agreement. He always agreed 100% with everything I said.
That's correct, Mr. Herriot. That's what I said.
But these animals are at least a year old. Mr. Ripley shrugged and gave me a world-weary smile.
Aye, well, time gets on, doesn't it? Fairly races by.
I returned to the car for the local anaesthetic. All right, I grunted as I filled the syringe. If you can catch them, I'll see what I can do. The farmer lifted a rope halter from a hook on the wall and approached one of the big beasts, murmuring encouragingly. He snared the nose with surprising ease, dropping the loops over nose and horn with perfect timing as the animal tried to plunge past him. Then he passed the rope through a ring on the wall and pulled it tight.
They are, Mr. Herriot. That wasn't much trouble, was it?
I didn't say anything. I was the one who was going to have the trouble. I was working at the wrong end, nicely in range of the hooves, which would surely start flying if my patients didn't appreciate having a needle stuck into their testicles. Anyway, it had to be done. One by one, I infiltrated the scrotal area with the local, taking the blows on my arms and legs as they came. Then I started the actual process of castration, the bloodless crushing of the spermatic cord without breaking the skin. There was no doubt this was a big advance on the old method of incising the scrotum with a knife, and in little calves it was a trifling business lasting only a few seconds. But it was altogether different with these vast creatures. It was necessary to open the arms of the Badizzo beyond right angles, to grip the great fleshy scrotum, and then they had to be closed again. That was when the fun started. Thanks to my injection, the beast could feel little or nothing, but as I squeezed desperately, it seemed that I was attempting the impossible. However, it is amazing what the human frame can accomplish when pushed to the utmost, and as the sweat trickled down my nose and I gasped and strained, the metal arms inched closer until the jaws finally clicked together. I always nipped each side twice, and I took a rest before repeating the process lower down the cord. When I had done the same with the other testicle, I flopped back against the wall, panting, and trying not to think of the other 7 beasts still to do. It was a long, long time before I got to the last one, and I was wrestling away, pop-eyed and open-mouthed, when the idea came to me. I straightened up and came along the side of the animal. "Mr. Ripley," I said breathlessly, "why don't you have a go?" "Eh?" The farmer had been watching me with equanimity, blowing out slow clouds of blue smoke, but it was plain that I had jolted him out of his composure. "What do you mean?" "Well, this is the last one, and I want you to understand what I've been talking about. I'd like to see you close those nippers." He thought the matter over for a moment or two.
"Aye, but who's going to old beast?"
"That's all right," I said. "We'll tie him up short to the ring, and I'll set everything up for you. Then we'll see how you get on." He looked a little doubtful, but I was determined to make my point and ushered him gently to the rear end of the animal. I enclosed the scrotum in the burdizzo and placed Mr. Ripley's fingers round the handles.
"Right," I said. "Off you go."
The farmer took a long breath, braced himself, and began to exert pressure on the metal arms. Nothing happened. I stood there for several minutes as his face turned red, then purple, his eyes protruded even further than mine, and the veins on his forehead stood out in livid ridges. Finally, he gave a groan and dropped to his knees.
"Nay, lad, nay, it's no good. I can't do it."
He got to his feet slowly and mopped his brow. "But, Mr. Ripley..." I put a hand on his shoulder and smiled kindly at him. "You expect me to do it?" He nodded dumbly.
"Oh, well, never mind," I said.
"You understand now what I've been talking about. This is an easy little job made difficult by leaving it until the beasts are as big as this.
If you'd called me out when they were calves of 3 months, I'd have been on and off your place in a few minutes, wouldn't I?" "Ah, you would, Mr. Herriot, you're right. I've been daft, and I'll see it doesn't happen again."
I felt really clever. I don't often have moments of inspiration, but the conviction swelled in me that one of them had come to me today. I had finally got through to Mr. Ripley. The feeling of exhilaration gave me added strength, and I finished the job effortlessly. As I walked to the car, I positively glowed, and my self-satisfaction deepened when the farmer bent to the window as I started the engine.
"Well, thank you, Mr. Herriot," he said. "You've taught me something this morning. Next time you come, I'll have a nice new gate for you, and I'll never ask you to nip big beasts like that again. I guarantee it."
All that had happened a long time ago, before the RAF, and I was now in the process of reinserting myself into civilian life, tasting the old things which I had almost forgotten. But at the moment when the phone rang, I was tasting something very near to my heart, Helen's cooking. It was Sunday lunchtime when the traditional roast beef and Yorkshire pudding was served. My wife had just dropped a slab of the pudding on my plate and was pouring gravy over it, a rich brown flood with the soul of the meat in it and an aroma to dream of. I was starving after a typical country vet Sunday morning of rushing round the farms, and I was thinking, as I often did, that if I had some foreign gourmet to impress with the choicest sample of our British food, then this is what I would give him. A great chunk of Yorkshire pud and gravy was the expedient of the thrifty farmers to fill their family stomachs before the real meal started.
"Them as eats most pudding gets most meat," was the wily encouragement.
But it was heaven. And as I chewed my first forkful, I was happy in the knowledge that when I had cleared my plate, Helen would fill it again with the beef itself, and with potatoes, peas and runner beans gathered from our garden that morning. The shrilling phone cut cruelly into my reverie, but I told myself that nothing was going to spoil this meal. The most urgent job in veterinary practice could wait until I'd finished. But my hand shook as I lifted the receiver, and a mixture of anxiety and disbelief flowed through me as I heard the voice at the other end. It was Mr. Ripley. Oh, please, no. Not that long, long trek to Anson Hall on a Sunday. The farmer's voice thundered in my ear. He was one of the many who still thought you had to bawl lustily to cover the miles between.
"Is that veterinary?"
"Yes, Herriot speaking."
"Oh, you're back from war, then?"
"Yes, that's right."
"Well, I want you to come out here right away. One of me cows is right bad."
"What's the trouble? Is it urgent?"
"Aye, it is. I think she's maybe broke a leg."
I held the earpiece away from me. Mr. Ripley had increased his volume and my head was beginning to ring. "What makes you think that?" I asked, suddenly dry-mouthed.
"Well,
She's on three legs, the farmer blasted back at me.
And t'other sort of hanging-like.
Oh, God, that sounded horribly significant. I looked sadly across the room at my loaded plate.
All right, Mr. Ripley, I'll be along.
You'll come straight away, won't you? Right now?
The voice was an importunate roar. Yes, I'll come straight away. I put down the receiver, rubbed my ear, and turned to my wife. Helen looked up from the table with the stricken face of a woman who can visualize her Yorkshire pudding sagging into lifeless ruin. Oh, surely you don't have to go this minute. I'm sorry, Helen, this is one of those things I can't leave. I could picture only too easily the injured animal plunging around in her agony, perhaps compounding the fracture. And the man sounds desperate. I just got to go. My wife's lips trembled. All right, I'll put it in the oven till you come back. As I left, I saw her carrying the plate away. We both knew it was the end. No Yorkshire pud could survive a visit to Anson Hall. I increased my speed as I drove through Derby. The cobbled marketplace, sleeping in the sunshine, breathed its Sunday peace and emptiness, with all the inhabitants of the little town eating busily behind closed doors. Out in the country, the dry stone walls flashed by as I kept my foot on the boards, and when I finally arrived at the beginning of the farm track, I had a sense of shock. It was the first time I had been there since I left the service, and I suppose I had been expecting to find something different. But the old iron gate was just the same, except that it was even more rusty than before. With a growing feeling of doom, I fought my way through the other gates, untying the strings and shouldering the top spars round until finally I came to number 7. This last and most terrible of the gates was still there, and unchanged. It couldn't be true, I told myself as I almost tiptoed towards it. All sorts of things had happened to me since I last saw it. I had been away in a different world of marching and drilling and learning navigation, and finally flying an aeroplane, while this rickety structure stood there unheeding. I eyed it closely. The loose-nailed wobbly timbers were as before, as was the single-string hinge. Probably the same piece of string. It was unbelievable. And then I noticed something different. Mr. Ripley, apparently worried lest his livestock might rub against and damage the ancient bastion, had festooned the thing with barbed wire. Maybe it had mellowed with time. It couldn't be as vicious as before. Gingerly, I loosened the bottom string on the right-hand side, then with infinite care I untied the bow at the top. I was just thinking that it was going to be easy when the binder twine fell away and the gate swung with all its old venom on the left-hand string. It got me on the chest first, then whacked against my legs, and this time the steel barbs bit through my trousers. Frantically, I tried to throw the thing away from me, but it pounded me high and low, and when I leant back to protect my chest, my legs slid from under me and I fell on my back. And as my shoulders hit the track, the gate, with a soft, woody crunch, fell on top of me. I had been nearly underneath this gate several times in the past, and had got clear at the last moment, but this time it had really happened. I tried to wriggle out, but the barbed wire had got my clothing in its iron grip. I was trapped. I craned desperately over the timbers. The farm was only 50 yards away, but there was not a soul in sight. And that was a funny thing. Where was the anxious farmer? I had expected to find him pacing up and down the yard, wringing his hands, but the place seemed deserted. I dallied with the idea of shouting for help, but that would have been just too absurd. There was nothing else for it. I seized the top rail in both hands and pushed upwards, trying to close my ears to the tearing sounds of my garments. Then, very slowly, I eased my way to safety. I left the gate lying where it was. Normally, I meticulously closed all gates behind me, but there were no cattle in the fields, and anyway, I'd had enough of this one. I rapped sharply on the farmhouse door, and Mrs. Ripley answered. "Now then, Mr. Herriot, it's grand weather," she said. Her carefree smile reminded me of her husband's as she wiped at a dinner plate and adjusted the apron round her ample midriff. "Yes, yes, it is. I've called to see your cow. Is your husband in?" She shook her head. "Nay, he hasn't got back from Fox and Hounds yet." "What?" I stared at her. That's the pub at Diverton, isn't it? I thought he had an urgent case for me to see. Aye, well, he had to go across there to ring you up. We haven't no telephone here, you know. Her smile widened. But that was nearly an hour since. He should have been back here long ago. That's right, she said, nodding with perfect understanding. But he'll have met some of his pals up there. They all get into Fox and Hounds on a Sunday morning. I churned my hair round. Mrs. Ripley, I've left my meal lying on the table so that I could get here immediately. Oh, we've had ours, she replied, as though the words would be a comfort to me, and she didn't have to tell me. The rich scent drifting from the kitchen was unmistakably roast beef, and there was no doubt at all that it would have been preceded by Yorkshire pudding. I didn't say anything for a few moments, then I took a deep breath. Well, maybe I can see the cow. Where is she, please? Mrs. Ripley pointed to a box at the far end of the yard. She's in there. As I set off across the cobble, she called after me. You can be looking at her till he gets back. He won't be many minutes. I flinched as though a lash had fallen across my shoulders. Those were dreadful words. Not many minutes was a common phrase in Yorkshire, and could mean anything up to 2 hours. I opened the half door and looked into the box at the cow. She was very lame, but when I approached her, she hopped around in the straw, dotting the injured limb on the ground. Well, she hadn't a broken leg. She couldn't take her weight on it, but there was none of the typical dangling of the limb. I felt a surge of relief. In a big animal, a fracture usually meant the humane killer, because no number of plaster bandages could take the strain. The trouble seemed to be in her foot, but I couldn't catch her to find out. I'd have to wait for Mr. Ripley. I went out into the afternoon sunshine and gazed over the gently rising fields to the church tower of Diverton pushing from the trees. There was no sign of the farmer, and I walked wearily beyond the buildings onto the grass to await his coming. I looked back at the house, and even through my exasperation I felt a sense of peace. Like many of the older farms, Anson Hall had once been a noble manor. Hundreds of years ago, some person of title had built his dwelling in a beautiful place. The roof looked ready to fall in, and one of the tall chimney stacks leaned drunkenly to one side. But the mullioned windows, the graceful arched doorways, and the stately proportions of the building were a delight, with the pastures beyond stretching towards the green fells. And that garden wall. In its former glory, the sun-warmed stones would have enclosed a cropped lawn with bright flowers, but now there were only nettles. Those nettles fascinated me, a waist-high jungle filling every inch of space between wall and house. Farmers are notoriously bad gardeners, but Mr. Ripley was in a class by himself. My reverie was interrupted by a cry from the lady of the house.
He's come in, Mr. Herriot. I've just spotted him through window.
She came round to the front and pointed towards Diverton. Her husband was indeed on his way, a black dot moving unhurriedly down through the fields, and we watched him together for about 15 minutes until at last he squeezed through a gap in the wall and came up to us, the smoke of his pipe rising around his ears. I went straight into the attack.
Mr. Ripley, I've been waiting a long time. You asked me to come straight away.
I know, but I couldn't very well ask to use phone without having a pint, could I?
He put his head on one side and beamed at me, secure in his unanswerable logic. I was about to speak when he went on.
And then Dick Henderson bought me one, so I had to buy him one back, and then I was just leaving when Bobby Talbot started on about them pigs he got from me last week.
His wife chipped in with bright curiosity.
Eee, that Bobby Talbot. Was he there this morning too? He's never away from pub, that fella.
I don't know how his missus puts up with it.
Aye, Bobby was there all right. He allus is.
Mr. Ripley smiled gently, knocked his pipe out against his heel and began to refill it.
And I'll tell you who else I saw. Dan Thompson. Haven't seen him since his operation. By God, has fleeced him. He's lost a bit of ground. Looks as though a few pints were doing good.
Danny,
Mrs. Ripley said eagerly.
That's good news, any road. From what I heard, they thought he'd never come out of hospital.
Excuse me, I broke in.
Nay, that was just talk,
Mr. Ripley continued.
It was nobody but a stone in kidney. Dan'll be all right.
He was telling me, I held up a hand. Mr. Ripley, can I please see this cow?
I haven't had my lunch yet. My wife put it back in the oven when you phoned.
Oh, I had mine before I went up there.
He gave me a reassuring smile, and his wife nodded and laughed to put my mind fully at rest.
Well, that's splendid, I said frigidly. I'm glad to hear that.
But I could see that they took me at my word. The sarcasm was lost on them.
In the loose box, Mr. Ripley halted the cow and I lifted the foot. Cradling it on my knee, I scraped away the caked muck with a hoof knife, and there, glinting dully as the sunshine slanted in at the door, was the cause of the trouble. I seized the metal stud with forceps, dragged it from the foot, and held it up. The farmer blinked at it for a few seconds, then his shoulders began to shake gently.
One of me own hobnails! Well, that's a rum un. I must have knocked it out on the cobbles there, right? Slippery over here. Once or twice, I've nearly gone arse over tip. I was saying to Mrs. just t'other day,
I really must get on, Mr. Ripley, I interposed. Remember, I still haven't had my lunch. I'll just slip out to the car for an anti-tetanus injection for the cow.
I gave it a shot, dropped the syringe into my pocket, and was on my way across the yard when the farmer called after me.
Have you got your nippers with you, Mr. Herriot?
Nippers? I halted and looked back at him. I couldn't believe this.
Well, yes, I have, but surely you don't want to start castrating calves now.
The farmer flicked an ancient brass lighter and applied a long sheet of flame to the bowl of his pipe.
There's not but one, Mr. Herriot. Won't take a minute.
Ah, well, I thought as I opened the boot and fished out the badizzo from its resting place on my carving overall. It didn't really matter now. My Yorkshire pudding was a write-off, a dried-up husk by now, and the beef and those gorgeous fresh vegetables would be almost cremated. All was lost, and nipping a calf wasn't going to make any difference. As I turned back, a pair of double doors at the end of the yard burst open, and an enormous black animal galloped out and looked around him warily in the bright sunshine, pawing the ground and swishing his tail bad-temperedly. I stared at the spreading horns, the great hump of muscle on the shoulder, and the coldly glittering eyes. It only needed a blast on a trumpet and sand instead of cobbles, and I was in the Plaza de Toros in Madrid.
"Is that the calf?" I asked.
The farmer nodded cheerfully.
"Aye, that's him. I thought I'd better run him over to the cowhouse so we could tie him up by the neck."
A wave of rage swept over me, and for a moment I thought I was going to start shouting at the man. Then, strangely, I felt only a great weariness. I walked over to him, put my face close to his, and spoke quietly. "Mr. Ripley, it's a long time since we met, and you've had plenty of opportunities to keep the promise you made me then. Remember? About getting your calves nipped when they were little, and about replacing that gate. Now look at that great bull, and see what your gate has done to my clothes." The farmer gazed with genuine concern at the snags and tears in my trousers, and reached out to touch a gaping rent in my sleeve.
"Eh, I'm right sorry about that."
He glanced at the bull.
"And I reckon he is a bit big."
I didn't say anything, and after a few minutes the farmer threw up his head and looked me in the eye, a picture of resolution.
"Aye, it's not right," he said. "But I'll tell you something. Just nip this one today, and I'll see none of this ever happens again."
I wagged a finger at him. "But you've said that before. Do you really mean it this time?"
He nodded vigorously.
"I'll guarantee it."
Chapter 2.
The broken-hearted sobbing jerked me into full wakefulness. It was 1 a.m., and after the familiar jangling of the bedside phone, I expected the gruff voice of a farmer with a calving cow. Instead, there was this terrible sound.
"Who is this?" I asked a little breathlessly. "What on earth is the trouble?"
I heard a gulping at the other end, and then a man's voice pleading between sobs.
"It's Humphrey Cobb. For God's sake, come out and see Myrtle. I think she's dying.
Myrtle?
Aye. Me poor little dog. She's in hell of a state.
The receiver trembled in my grasp. What is she doing?
Oh, panting and gasping. I think it's nearly over with her. Come quick.
Where do you live?
Cedar House, end of Hill Street.
I know it. I'll be there very soon.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Myrtle hasn't got long. Hurry! Hurry!
I leapt from the bed and rushed at my clothes, draped over a chair against the wall. In my haste in the darkness, I put both feet down one leg of my working corduroys and crashed full length on the floor. Helen was used to nocturnal calls, and often she only half woke. For my part, I always tried to avoid disturbing her by dressing without switching on the light. There was always a glow from the nightlight we kept burning on the landing for young Jimmy. However, the system broke down this time. The thud of my falling body brought her into a sitting position. What is it, Jim? What's happening? I struggled to my feet. It's all right, Helen. I just tripped over. I snatched my shirt from the chair back. But what are you dashing about for? Desperately urgent case. I have to hurry. All right, Jim, but you won't get there any sooner by going on like this. Just calm down. My wife was right, of course. I have always envied those vets who can stay relaxed under pressure, but I wasn't made that way. I galloped down the stairs and through the long back garden to the garage. Cedar House was only a mile away, and I didn't have much time to think about the case, but by the time I arrived, I had pretty well decided that an acute dyspnea like this would probably be caused by a heart attack or some sudden allergy. In answer to my ring, the porch light flashed on, and Humphrey Cobb stood before me. He was a little round man in his 60s, and his Humpty Dumpty appearance was accentuated by his gleaming bald head.
"Oh, Mr. Herriot, come in, come in!" he cried brokenly as the tears streamed down his face. "Thank you for getting out of your bed to help me, poor little Myrtle!"
As he spoke, the blast of whiskey fumes almost made my head spin, and I noticed that as he preceded me across the hall, he staggered slightly. My patient was lying in a basket by the side of an Aga cooker in a large, well-appointed kitchen. I felt a warm surge when I saw that she was a beagle like my own dog, Sam. I knelt down and looked at her closely. Her mouth was open and her tongue lolled, but she did not seem to be in acute distress. In fact, as I patted her head, her tail flapped against the blanket. A heart-rending wail sounded in my ear.
"Oh, what do you make of her, Mr. Herriot? It's a heart, isn't it? Oh, Myrtle, Myrtle!"
The little man crouched over his pet and the tears flowed unchecked. "You know, Mr. Cobb," I said, "she doesn't seem all that bad to me, so don't upset yourself too much. Just give me a chance to examine her." I placed my stethoscope over the ribs and listened to the steady thudding of a superbly strong heart. The temperature was normal, and I was palpating the abdomen when Mr. Cobb broke in again.
"The trouble is," he gasped, "I neglect this poor little animal."
"What do you mean?"
"Well, I've been all day at Catterick at the races, gambling and drinking, with never a thought for me dog."
"You left her alone all that time in the house?"
"Nay, nay, missus has been with her."
"Well, then." I felt I was getting out of my depth. "She would feed Myrtle and let her out in the garden."
"Oh, aye,"
he said, wringing his hands.
"But I shouldn't leave her. She thinks such a lot about me."
As he spoke, I could feel one side of my face tingling with heat. My problem was suddenly solved.
"You've got her too near the Aga," I said. "She's panting because she's uncomfortably hot."
He looked at me doubtfully.
"We just shifted her basket today. We've been getting some new tiles put down on the floor."
"Right," I said. "Shift it back again and she'll be fine."
"But Mr. Herriot..."
His lips began to tremble again.
"It's more than that. She's suffering. Look at her eyes."
Myrtle had the lovely big liquid eyes of her breed, and she knew how to use them. Many people think that the spaniel is number one when it comes to looking soulful, but I personally plump for the beagle, and Myrtle was an expert.
"Oh, I shouldn't worry about that, Mr. Cobb," I said.
"Believe me, she'll be all right." He still seemed unhappy.
"But are you going to do something?"
It was one of the great questions in veterinary practice. If you didn't do something,
They were not satisfied, and in this case Mr. Cobb was in greater need of treatment than his pet. Still, I wasn't going to stick a needle into Myrtle just to please him, so I produced a vitamin tablet from my bag and pushed it over the back of the little animal's tongue. "There you are," I said. "I'm sure that will do her good." And after all, I thought, I wasn't a complete charlatan. He wouldn't do her any harm. Mr. Cobb relaxed visibly.
"Eh, that's champion. You've set me mind at rest."
He led the way into a luxurious drawing room and tacked unsteadily towards the cocktail cabinet.
"You'll have a drink before you go?"
"No, really, thanks," I said. "I'd rather not, if you don't mind."
"Well, I'll have a drop, just to steady me nerves. I was that upset."
He tipped a lavish measure of whiskey into a glass and waved me to a chair. My bed was calling me, but I sat down and watched as he drank. He told me that he was a retired bookmaker from the West Riding and that he had come to Darabee only a month ago. Although no longer directly connected with horse racing, he still loved the sport and never missed a meeting in the north of England.
"I always get a taxi to take me, and I have a right good day."
His face was radiant as he recalled the happy times. Then for a moment his cheeks quivered and his woebegone expression returned.
"But I neglect me dog. I leave her at home."
"Oh, nonsense," I said. "I've seen you out in the fields with Myrtle. You give her plenty of exercise, don't you?"
"Oh, aye, lots of walks every day."
"Well, then she really has a good life. This is just a silly little notion you've got." He beamed at me and sloshed out another few fingers of whiskey.
"Eh, you're a good lad. Come on. You'll just have one before you go."
"Oh, all right. Just a small one, then." As we drank, he became more and more benign until he was gazing at me with something like devotion.
"James Herriot," he slurred. "I suppose it'll be Jim, eh?"
"Well, yes."
"I'll call you Jim, then. And you can call me Humphrey."
"OK, Humphrey," I said, and swallowed the last of my whiskey, "but I really must go now." Out in the street, he put a hand on my arm and his face became serious again.
"Thank you, Jim. Myrtle was right bad tonight, and I'm grateful."
Driving away, I realised that I had failed to convince him that there was nothing wrong with his dog. He was sure I had saved a life. It had been an unusual visit, and as my 2 a.m. whiskey burned in my stomach, I decided that Humphrey Cobb was a very funny little man. But I liked him. After that night, I saw him quite frequently exercising Myrtle in the fields. With his almost spherical build, he seemed to bounce over the grass. But his manner was always self-contained and rational, except that he kept thanking me for pulling his dog back from the jaws of death. Then, quite suddenly, I was back at the beginning again. It was shortly after midnight, and as I lifted the bedside phone, I could hear the distraught weeping before the receiver touched my ear.
"Oh, Jim, Jim, Myrtle's in a terrible bad way. Will you come?"
"What? What is it this time?"
"She's twitching."
"Twitching?"
"Aye. Twitching something terrible. Oh, come on, Jim, lad, don't keep me waiting. I'm worried to death. I'm sure she's got distemper."
He broke down again. My head began to reel. "She can't have distemper, Humphrey, not in a flash like that."
"I'm begging you, Jim,"
he went on as though he hadn't heard.
"Be a pal. Come and see Myrtle."
"All right," I said wearily. "I'll be there in a few minutes."
"Oh, you're a good lad, Jim. You're a good lad."
The voice trailed away as I replaced the phone. I dressed at normal speed with none of the panic of the first time. It sounded like a repetition, but why after midnight again? On my way to Cedar House, I decided it must be another false alarm. But you never knew. The same dizzying wave of whiskey fumes enveloped me in the porch. Humphrey, sniffing and moaning, fell against me once or twice as he ushered me into the kitchen. He pointed to the basket in the corner.
"There she is,"
he said, wiping his eyes.
"I've just got back from Ripon and found her like this."
"Racing again, eh?"
"Aye, gambling on them hosses and drinking and leaving me poor dog pining at home. I'm a rotter, Jim, that's what I am."
"Rubbish, Humphrey. I've told you before, you're not doing her any harm by having a day out. Anyway, how about this twitching?"
She looks all right now.
Yes. She stopped doing it, but when I came in, her back leg was going like this.
He made a jerking movement with his hand. I groaned inwardly. But she could have been scratching or flicking away a fly.
Nay, there's something more than that. I can tell she's suffering. Look at them eyes.
I could see what he meant. Myrtle's beagle eyes were pools of emotion, and it was easy to read a melting reproach in their depths. With a feeling of futility, I examined her. I knew what I would find. Nothing. But when I tried to explain to the little man that his pet was normal, he wouldn't have it.
Oh, but you'll give her one of them wonderful tablets,
he pleaded.
It cured her last time.
I felt I had to pacify him, so Myrtle received another instalment of vitamins. Humphrey was immensely relieved and weaved his way to the drawing room and the whiskey bottle.
I need a little pick-me-up after that shock, he said. You'll have one too, won't you, Jim, lad?
This pantomime was enacted frequently over the next few months, always after race meetings and always between midnight and 1 a.m. I had ample opportunity to analyse the situation, and I came to a fairly obvious conclusion. Most of the time, Humphrey was a normal, conscientious pet owner. But after a large intake of alcohol, his affectionate feelings degenerated into a glutinous sentimentality and guilt. I invariably went out when he called me because I knew he would be deeply distressed if I refused. I was treating Humphrey, not Myrtle. It amused me that not once did he accept my protestations that my visit was unnecessary. Each time he was sure that my magic tablets had saved his dog's life. Mind you, I did not discount the possibility that Myrtle was deliberately working on him with those eyes. The canine mind is quite capable of disapproval. I took my own dog almost everywhere with me. But if I left him at home to take Helen to the cinema, he would lie under our bed, sulking, and when he emerged, would studiously ignore us for an hour or two. I quailed when Humphrey told me he had decided to have Myrtle mated, because I knew that the ensuing pregnancy would be laden with harassment for me. That was how it turned out. The little man flew into a series of alcoholic panics, all of them unfounded, and he discovered imaginary symptoms in Myrtle at regular intervals throughout the 9 weeks. I was vastly relieved when she gave birth to 5 healthy pups. Now, I thought, I would get some peace. The fact was that I was just about tired of Humphrey's nocturnal nonsense. I have always made a point of never refusing to turn out at night, but Humphrey had stretched this principle to breaking point. One of these times he would have to be told. The crunch came when the pups were a few weeks old. I had had a terrible day, starting with a prolapsed uterus in a cow at 5 a.m. and progressing through hours of road slogging, missed meals, and a late-night wrestle with ministry forms, some of which I suspected I had filled up wrongly. My clerical incompetence has always infuriated me. And when I crawled, dog-tired, into bed, my mind was still buzzing with frustration. I lay for a long time trying to put those forms away from me, and it was well after midnight when I fell asleep. I have always had a silly fancy that our practice knows when I desperately want a full night's sleep. It knows, and gleefully steps in. When the phone exploded in my ear, I wasn't really surprised. As I stretched a weary hand to the receiver, the luminous dial of the alarm clock read 1:15 a.m. Hello, I grunted. The reply was only too familiar. I clenched my teeth. This was just what I needed. Humphrey, what is it this time?
Oh, Jim, Myrtle's really dying. I know she is. Come quick, lad, come quick.
Dying? I took a couple of rasping breaths. How do you make that out?
Well, she's stretched out on her side, trembling.
Anything else?
Aye. Missus said Myrtle's been looking worried and walking stiff when she let her out in the garden this afternoon. I'm not long back from Redcar, you see.
So you've been to the races, eh?
That's right. Neglecting me dog. I'm a scamp. Nothing but a scamp.
I closed my eyes in the darkness. There was no end to Humphrey's imaginary symptoms. Trembling this time,
looking worried, walking stiff. We'd had panting and twitching and head nodding and ear shaking. What would it be next? But enough was enough. "Look, Humphrey," I said, "there's nothing wrong with your dog. I've told you again and again..."
"Oh, Jim, lad, don't be long."
"I'm not coming, Humphrey."
Nay, don't say that. She's going fast, I tell you."
"I really mean it. It's just wasting my time and your money, so go to bed. Myrtle will be fine." As I lay quivering between the sheets, I realised that refusing to go out was an exhausting business. There was no doubt in my mind that it would have taken less out of me to get up and attend another charade at Cedar House than to say no for the first time in my life. But this couldn't go on. I had to make a stand. I was still tormented by remorse when I fell into an uneasy slumber. And it is a good thing that the subconscious mind works on during sleep, because with the alarm clock reading 2:30 a.m. I came suddenly wide awake. "My God!" I cried, staring at the dark ceiling. "Myrtle's got eclampsia!" I scrambled from the bed and began to throw on my clothes. I must have made some commotion because I heard Helen's sleepy voice. "What is it? What's the matter?" "Humphrey Cobb," I gasped, tying a shoelace. "Humphrey... but you said there was never any hurry." "There is this time. His dog's dying." I glared again at the clock. In fact, she could be dead now. I lifted my tie, then held it back in the chair. "Damn it, I don't need that." I fled from the room. Down the long garden and into the car, with my brain spelling out the concise case history which Humphrey had given me. Small bitch nursing 5 puppies. Signs of anxiety and stiff gait this afternoon, and now prostrate and trembling. Classical puerperal eclampsia. Rapidly fatal without treatment, and it was nearly an hour and a half since he'd phoned. I couldn't bear to think about it. Humphrey was still up. He had obviously been consoling himself with the bottle because he could barely stand.
"You've come, Jim, lad,"
he mumbled, blinking at me. "Yes, how is she?"
"Just same."
Clutching my calcium and my intravenous syringe, I rushed past him into the kitchen. Myrtle's sleek body was extended in a tetanic spasm. She was gasping for breath, quivering violently, and bubbles of saliva dripped from her mouth. Those eyes had lost their softness and were fixed in a frantic stare. She looked terrible, but she was alive. She was alive. I lifted the squealing pups onto a rug nearby and quickly clipped and swabbed the area over the radial vein. I inserted the needle into the blood vessel and began to depress the plunger with infinite care and very slowly. Calcium was the cure for this condition, but a quick blast would surely kill the patient. I took several minutes to empty the syringe, then sat back on my heels and watched. Some of these cases needed narcotics as well as calcium, and I had Nembutal and morphine ready to hand. But as the time passed, Myrtle's breathing slowed down and the rigid muscles began to relax. When she started to swallow her saliva and look around at me, I knew she would live. I was waiting for the last tremors to disappear from her limbs when I felt a tap on my shoulder. Humphrey was standing there with the whiskey bottle in his hand.
"You'll have one, won't you, Jim?"
I didn't need much persuading. The knowledge that I had almost been responsible for Myrtle's death had thrown me into a mild degree of shock. My hand was still shaking as I raised the glass, and I had barely taken the first sip when the little animal got up from the basket and walked over to inspect her pups. Some eclampsias were slow to respond, but others were spectacularly quick, and I was grateful for the sake of my nervous system that this was one of the quick ones. In fact, the recovery was almost uncanny, because after sniffing her family over, Myrtle walked across the table to greet me. Her eyes brimmed with friendliness, and her tail waved high in the true beagle fashion. I was stroking her ears when Humphrey broke into a throaty giggle.
"You know, Jim, I've learnt summat tonight."
His voice was a slow drawl, but he was still in possession of his wits. "What's that, Humphrey?"
I've learnt what a silly fella I've been all these months."
"How do you mean?" He raised a forefinger and wagged it sagely.
"Well, you've always been telling me that I got you out of bed for nothing, and I was imagining things when I thought me dog was ill."
"Yes," I said, "that's right."
"And I never believed you, did I? I wouldn't be told."
Well, now I know you were right all the time. I've been nubber to fool. And I'm right sorry for bothering you all those nights.
Oh, I shouldn't worry about that, Humphrey.
Aye, but it's not right.
He waved a hand towards his bright-faced, tail-wagging little dog.
Just look at it. Anybody can see there was never anything wrong with Myrtle tonight.
Chapter 3. The high moorland road was unfenced, and my car wheels ran easily from the strip of tarmac onto the turf, cropped to a velvet closeness by the sheep. I stopped the engine, got out and looked around me. The road cut cleanly through the grass and heather before dipping into the valley beyond. This was one of the good places, where I could see into two dales, the one I had left and the one in front. The whole land was spread beneath me. The soft fields and the valley floors, the grazing cattle, and the rivers, pebbled at their edges in places, thickly fringed with trees at others. The brilliant green of the walled pastures pushed up the sides of the fells until the heather and the harsh moor grass began, and only the endless pattern of walls was left climbing to the mottled summits, disappearing over the bare ridges which marked the beginning of the wild country. I leant back against the car and the wind blew the cold, sweet air around me. I had been only a few weeks back in civilian life, and during my time in RAF Blue I had thought constantly of Yorkshire. But I had forgotten how beautiful it was. Just thinking from afar could not evoke the peace, the solitude, the sense of the nearness of the wild which makes the dales thrilling and comforting at the same time. Among the crowds of men and the drabness and the stale air of the towns, I could not really imagine a place where I could be quite alone on the wide green roof of England, and where every breath was filled with the grass scent. I had had a disturbing morning. Everywhere I had gone, I was reminded that I had come back to a world of change, and I did not like change. One old farmer saying, "It's Alt Needle now, Mr. Herriot," as I injected his cow, had made me look down almost with surprise at the syringe in my hand, realizing suddenly that this is what I was doing most of the time. I knew what he meant. Only a few years ago, I would have been more likely to have drenched his cow, grabbed it by the nose and poured a pint of medicine down its throat. We still carried a special drenching bottle around with us. An empty wine bottle, because it had no shoulders and allowed the liquid to run more easily. Often we would mix the medicine with black treacle from the barrel which stood in the corner of most cow buyers. All this was disappearing, and the farmer's remark about Alt Needle brought it home to me once more that things were never going to be the same again. A revolution had begun in agriculture and in veterinary practice. Farming had become more scientific, and concepts cherished for generations were being abandoned, while in the veterinary world, the first trickles of the flood of new advances were being felt. Previously undreamt of surgical procedures were being carried out. The sulfur drugs were going full blast, and, most exciting of all, the war, with its urgent need for better treatment of wounds, had given a tremendous impetus to the development of Sir Alexander Fleming's discovery of penicillin. This, the first of the antibiotics, was not yet in the hands of the profession, except in the form of intramammary tubes for the treatment of mastitis. But it was the advance guard of the therapeutic army which was to sweep our old treatments into oblivion. There were signs, too, that the small farmer was on the way out. These men, some with only six cows, a few pigs and poultry, still made up most of our practice, and were the truly rich characters. But they were beginning to wonder if they could make a living on this scale, and one or two had sold out to the bigger men. In our practice now, in the 80s, there are virtually no small farmers left. I can think of only a handful. Old men doggedly doing the things they have always done for the sole reason that they have always done it. They are the last remnants of the men I cherished, living by the ancient values, speaking the old Yorkshire dialect which television and radio have almost extinguished. I took a last long breath and got into my car. The uncomfortable feeling of change was still with me, but I looked through the window at the great fells thrusting their bald summits into the clouds, tier upon tier of them, timeless, indestructible, towering over the glories beneath, and I felt better immediately. The dales had not changed at all. I did one more call, then drove back to Skeldale House to see if there were any more visits before lunch. All was new here, too. My partner Siegfried had married and was living a few miles outside Derby, and Helen and I, with our little son Jimmy, were installed in the practice headquarters. When I got out of the car, I gazed up at the ivy climbing over the mellow brick to the little rooms which looked out from under the tiles to the hills. Helen and I had started our married life in those rooms, but now we had the run of the whole house. It was too big for us, of course, but we were happy to be there because we both loved the old place, with its spaciousness and its Georgian elegance. The house looked much the same as when I'd first seen it those years ago. The only difference was that they had taken the iron railings away for scrap metal during the war, and our plates were now hanging on the wall. Helen and I slept in the big room which I occupied in my bachelor days, and Jimmy was in the dressing room, where Siegfried's student brother Tristan used to rest his head. Tristan, alas, had left us. When the war ended, he was Captain Farnan of the Royal Army Veterinary Corps. He married and joined the Ministry of Agriculture as an infertility investigation officer. He left a sad gap in our lives, but fortunately we still saw him and his wife regularly. I opened the front door, and in the passage the fragrance of Pulv Aromat was strong. It was the aromatic powder which we mixed with our medicaments, and it had an excitement for me. It always seemed to be hanging about the house. It was the smell of our trade. Halfway along the passage, I passed the doorway to the long high-walled garden and turned into the dispensary. This was a room whose significance was already on the wane. The rows of beautifully shaped glass bottles with their Latin titles engraved on them looked down on me. Spiritus Aetheris Nitrosi, Liquor Ammoniae Acetatis Fortis, Potassii Nitrus, Sodii Salicylus. Noble names. My head was stuffed with hundreds of them. Their properties, actions, and uses, and their dosage in horse, ox, sheep, pig, dog, and cat. But soon I would have to forget them all, and concern myself only with how much of the latest antibiotic or steroid to administer. Some years were to pass before the steroids arrived on the scene, but they too would bring another little revolution in their wake. As I left the dispensary, I almost bumped into Siegfried. He was storming along the passage and he grabbed my arm in an agitated manner.
Ah, James, just the man I was looking for. I've had the most ghastly time this morning. I knocked the exhaust off my car going up that bloody awful track to High Liston, and now I'm without transport. They've sent for a new exhaust, but until it arrives and they get it fitted, I'm stuck. It's maddening.
That's all right, Siegfried, I'll do your calls.
No, no, James, it's kind of you, but don't you see? This sort of thing is going to happen again and again. That's what I wanted to talk to you about. We need a spare car.
A spare?
That's right. Doesn't have to be a Rolls-Royce, just something to fall back on at a time like this. As a matter of fact, I rang Hammond at the garage to bring round something suitable for us to look at. I think I can hear him outside now.
My partner was always one for instant action, and I followed him out to the front door. Mr. Hammond was there with the vehicle for our inspection. It was a 1933 Morris Oxford, and Siegfried trotted down the steps towards it.
£100, you said, eh, Mr. Hammond?
He walked around the car a couple of times, picking off pieces of rust from the black paintwork, opening the doors and peering at the upholstery.
Ah, well, it's seen better days, but the appearance doesn't matter as long as it goes all right.
It's a sound little job, Mr. Farnin,
the garage proprietor said.
Reboard 2,000 miles ago, and don't hardly use any oil. New battery, and a good bit of tread on the tyres.
He adjusted the spectacles on his long nose, drew his thin frame upright, and adopted a businesslike expression.
Hmm.
Siegfried shook the rear bumper with his foot, and the old springs groaned.
How about the brakes? Important in the hilly country there, champion Mr. Farnin, first rate.
My colleague nodded slowly.
Good, good. You don't mind if I drive around the block, do you? Nay, nay, of course not.
Mr. Hammond replied.
Give her any trial you like.
He was a man who prided himself on his imperturbability, and he dropped confidently into the passenger seat as Siegfried took the wheel.
"Hop in the back, James," my partner cried. I opened the rear door and took my place behind Mr. Hammond in the musty interior.
Siegfried took off abruptly with a roaring and creaking from the old vehicle, and despite the garage man's outward calm, I saw the back of his shirt collar rise a couple of inches above his blue serge jacket as we shot along Trengate. The collar subsided a little when Siegfried slowed down at the church to make a left turn, but reappeared spasmodically as we negotiated a series of sharp and narrow bends at top speed. When we reached the long straight lane which runs parallel to Trengate, Mr. Hammond appeared to relax. But when Siegfried put his foot on the boards and sent the birds squawking from the overhanging branches as he thundered beneath them, I saw the collar again. When we reached the end of the lane, Siegfried came almost to a halt as he turned left.
"I think we'll test the brakes, Mr. Hammond," he said cheerfully, and hurled the car suddenly along the home straight for Trengate.
He really meant to carry out a thorough test. The roar of the ancient engine rose to a scream, and as the street approached with frightening rapidity, the collar reappeared, then the shirt. When Siegfried stood on the brakes, the car slewed violently to the right, and as we catapulted crabwise into Trengate, Mr. Hammond's head was jammed against the roof and his entire shirt back was exposed. When we came to a halt, he slid slowly back into his seat and the jacket took over again. At no time had he spoken or, apart from his up-and-down movements, shown any emotion. At the front door of the surgery, we got out and my colleague rubbed his chin doubtfully.
"She does pull a little to the right on braking, Mr. Hammond. I think we'd need to have that rectified, or perhaps you have another vehicle available."
The garage man did not answer for a few moments. His spectacles were askew and he was very pale.
"I, he said shakily, "I have another little job over there. It might suit you."
"Capital!" Siegfried rubbed his hands. "Perhaps you'd bring it along after lunch and we can have a spin round to try it."
Mr. Hammond's eyes widened and he swallowed a few times.
"Right. Right, Mr. Farnan. But I'm going to be busy this afternoon. I'll send one of me men."
We bade him goodbye and went back into the house. Walking along the passage, my partner put an arm across my shoulders.
"Well, James, another step towards increasing the efficiency of the practice. Anyway," he smiled and whistled a few cheerful bars, "I rather enjoy these little interludes."
Suddenly, I began to feel good. So many things were new and different, but the Dales hadn't changed, and Siegfried hadn't changed either.
Chapter 4
A voyage to Russia? I stared at John Crooks. Siegfried and I worked alone in the practice during the immediate post-war years, and this book is about that period. In 1951, John Crooks came to us as an assistant, and 3 years later left to set up his own practice in Beverly. Before he departed, he paid us the charming compliment of filling a bottle with the air from Skeldale House, to be released in his new surgery with the object of transferring some of our atmosphere. Sometime in the future I shall write about John's spell in Darrowby, but at the moment I should like to jump forward in time to 1961 in order to interpolate some extracts from the journal I kept of my Russian adventure. John was behind it. Although he no longer worked for us, he came back often as a friend and had been describing some of his experiences in exporting animals from Hull. He often sailed with these animals as veterinary attendant, but it was the Russian thing which caught my imagination. "That must have been very interesting," I said. John smiled. "Oh, yes, fascinating. I've been out there several times now, and it's the real Russia with the lid off, not a tour of the show places they want you to see. You get a glimpse of the country through the eyes of the seamen, and you meet the ordinary Russians, the commercial people, the workers. Sounds great. And you get paid for it, too," John went on. "That makes it even better." I sighed. "You're a lucky beggar. And these jobs come up pretty regularly?" "Yes, they do." He looked at me closely, and I suppose my expression must have been wistful. "Would you like to have a go sometime?"
"Do you mean it?"
"Of course," he said.
"Just say the word and you can sail on the next one. That'll be sometime around the end of October."
I thumped my fist into my palm.
"Book me in, John."
"Oh, it's really kind of you. Country vetting is fine, but sometimes I feel I'm sliding into a rut. A trip to Russia's just what I need."
"Well, that's grand." John stood up and prepared to leave.
I'll let you know the details later, but I believe you'll be selling with a cargo of valuable sheep, breeding animals. The insurance company is bound to insist on veterinary supervision. For weeks I went around in a fever of anticipation, but there were many people who didn't share my enthusiasm. One cowman cocked an eye at me.
"I wouldn't go there for a bloody big clock," he said. "One wrong word and you'll find yourself in nick for a long, long time."
He had a definite point. East-West relations were at one of their lowest ebbs at that time, and I grew used to my clients making it clear that Russia was one place they would avoid. In fact, when I told Colonel Smallwood about it while I was tuberculin testing his cattle a few days before I left, he raised his eyebrows and gave me a cold stare. "Nice to have known you," he murmured. But I have seafarer's blood in my veins going back several generations, and I felt only happy expectation. October the 28th, 1961. The first day has come and gone. When I walked onto the quayside at Hull, I saw our ship right in front of me. She was Danish, the Iris Clausen, of 300 tons, and my first sensation was of mild shock that she was so small. I had cherished a mental picture of a substantial vessel for such a voyage. When I first saw her at the dockside, only the bows and a portion of deck were visible. This part looked tiny, and a high superstructure obscured what I surmised must be the greater part of the ship. I walked along past this superstructure and experienced a moment of disquiet. I found that the ship ended right there. There just wasn't any more. To my untutored eyes, the Iris Clausen looked like a toy oil tanker, and it was difficult to imagine her crossing an ocean or weathering a storm. The cargo of sheep had just been loaded and the decks were littered with straw. When I went into the little mess room, I saw the captain, who was called Rasmussen, sitting at the head of a table around which were grouped representatives of the export company and two Russian veterinary surgeons who had been inspecting the sheep. The table itself was heavily laden with a wonderful variety of Danish open sandwiches, beer, whiskey, schnapps and other drinks, and with mountains of forms which everybody was furiously signing. One of the Russians, a bespectacled little man, apparently realised who I was because he came up and with a smile said, "Veterinary surgeon," and shook my hand warmly. His colleague, tall and gaunt, was painstakingly going through the forms and saying nothing. The chief man from the export people informed me that not only was I to be the medical attendant to the 383 pedigree Romney Marsh and Lincoln sheep we were carrying, but I had also to deal with the Russians at our port of destination, Klaidida. I had to bring back 5 acceptance forms signed by the Russians and myself, otherwise the company would not get paid. "How much are the sheep worth?" I asked. The export man's mouth twitched up at one corner. £20,000. My stomach lurched. It was a fortune. This was a responsibility I hadn't foreseen. When the crowd had cleared, Captain Rasmussen and I were left alone in the room. He introduced himself charmingly, and I was immediately attracted by his gentle manner. He was smallish, silver-haired, and spoke excellent English. He waved me to a chair by his side. "Sit down, Mr. Herriot, and let us talk." We spoke about our families and then about the job in hand. "This is a motor ship," said the captain, "built for the sole purpose of transporting animals. There are 2 decks below with pens for the sheep. Perhaps you would like to see your charges?" As we left the mess room, I noticed that the captain was limping slightly. He smiled as he saw me looking down at his feet. "Yes, I broke my ankle a few months ago. Fell down the steps from the bridge to my cabin during a storm. Silly of me." I wondered if I would be doing any falling around over the next week or so. We walked around the sheep. Beautiful animals, all of them. And they were very comfortable, well bedded in straw and with lots of sweet hay to eat. The ventilation was just right, and the atmosphere pleasantly warm. When I left the captain, I was agreeably surprised at the first sight of my cabin. No doubt those on passenger liners were more sumptuous, but there was a bunk with spotless sheets and pillows, a desk, armchair and sofa, a wash basin, fitted wardrobes, 2 cupboards, and a lot of drawers. The whole place was done out in shining light oak. I was very impressed with my temporary home. I opened my suitcase. Only a tiny part of it was taken up by my personal effects. The rest was filled with the things I thought I might need. My black PVC working coat, Bottles of calcium, antibiotics and steroids, scalpel, scissors, suture materials, bandages, cotton wool and syringes. I looked down thoughtfully at the limited array. Would I find it too meagre? Or would I not need any of it? The following days would tell me. We took on the pilot at 8 p.m. and at 9 p.m. I heard some activity outside my window. I looked out and saw two of the crew winching up the anchor. I went up on deck to watch our departure. The night was very dark and the dockside was deserted. A cat scurried through the light thrown by a single street lamp, but nothing else stirred. Then our siren gave a loud blast, and I could see we were moving very slowly away from the quay. We glided through the narrow outlet of the dock, then began to head quite swiftly towards the mouth of the Humber, 2 miles away. As I stood on the deck, I could see several other ships sailing out on the evening tide, some quite close, cleaving through the water abreast of us only a few hundred yards away, a graceful and thrilling sight. Away behind, the lights of Hull receded rapidly, and I was looking at their faint glitter beyond the stretch of dark water when I felt a touch on my arm. It was a young sailor, and he grinned cheerfully as I turned round.
"Doctor," he said, "you show me how to feed the sheeps?"
I must have looked puzzled because his grin widened as he explained.
"Many times I deal with cattle and pigs, but never with sheeps."
I understood and motioned him to lead on. Like all the crew, he was a Dane, big, fair-haired, typically Nordic, and I followed his broad back down to the animals' pens. He listened intently as I gave him the information about feeding and watering, especially about how much concentrates to give. I was particularly pleased to see that as well as the fine quality hay, there was an abundance of a top-class brand of sheep nuts in big paper sacks. While he got on with his work, I looked around at the animals who would be under my care. Most of them were Romney Marsh sheep, and as the engines throbbed and the deck vibrated under my feet, I marvelled again at their attractiveness. They had great woolly heads like teddy bears, and their eyes, soft and incurious, looked back at me as they lay in the straw or nibbled at their food. Before I went to bed, I had an irresistible urge to return to the upper deck and look around. I have sea captains among my uncles and a great-grandfather who was a ship's pilot, and the sea has always had a pull for me. In the darkness, I walked around the deck. This wasn't easy because there was only a narrow strip 25 yards long on either side. The moon had come out, casting a cold, white brilliance on the water of the river estuary. Far on the starboard side, a long row of lights glimmered. Probably Grimsby. On the port side, about 300 yards away, a ship sped silently through the night, keeping pace exactly with us. I watched her for a long time, but her position never varied, and she was still with us when I came down to bed. My cabin was now a place of shakes and shudders, of indefinable bumps and rattles and groans. As I wrote up my diary, I knew for sure that we were well out to sea because I was very much aware of the rolling of the ship. I had an experimental lie on my bunk, and this was where the rolling was more noticeable. From side to side it went, side to side, over and over again. At one time there had been some talk of Helen coming with me on this trip, and I smiled to myself at the thought. This wouldn't suit her at all. She soon becomes queasy sitting in the back of a car. But to me the gentle motion was like the rocking of a cradle. I knew I should sleep well. Chapter 5.
"Hello! Hello!"
I bellowed.
"Hello! Hello!"
Little Jimmy piped just behind me. I turned and looked at my son. He was 4 years old now, and had been coming on my rounds with me for over a year. It was clear that he considered himself a veteran of the farmyards, an old hand versed in all aspects of agricultural lore. This shouting was a common habit of mine. When a vet arrived on a farm, it was often surprisingly difficult to find the farmer. He might be a dot on a tractor half a mile across the fields. On rare occasions, he might be in the house, but I always hoped to find him among the buildings and relied on a few brisk shouts to locate him. Certain farms in our practice were, for no apparent reason, distinctive in that you could never find anybody around. The house door would be locked, and we would scour the barns, cowhouses, and fold yards while our cries echoed back at us from the unheeding walls. Siegfried and I used to call them no-finding places, and they were responsible for a lot of wasted time. Jimmy had caught on to the problem quite early. and there was no doubt he enjoyed the opportunity to exercise his lungs a bit. I watched him now as he strutted importantly over the cobbles, giving tongue every few seconds. He was also making an unnecessary amount of noise by clattering on the rough stones with his new boots. Those boots were his pride, the final recognition of his status as veterinary assistant. When I began to take him round with me, his first reaction was the simple joy of a child at being able to see animals of all kinds, particularly the young ones, the lambs, foals, piglets, calves, and the thrill of discovery when he came upon a huddle of kittens in the straw, or found a bitch with pups in a loose box. Before long, however, he began to enlarge his horizons. He wanted to get into the action. The contents of my car boot were soon as familiar to him as his toy box at home, and he delighted in handing out the tins of stomach powder, the electuaries and red blisters, the white lotion, and the still-revered long cartons of universal cattle medicine. Finally, he began to forestall me by rushing back to the car for calcium and flutter valve as soon as he saw a recumbent cow. He had become a diagnostician as well. I think the thing he enjoyed most was accompanying me on an evening call if Helen would allow him to postpone his bedtime. He was in heaven driving into the country in the darkness, training my torch on a cow's teat while I stitched it. The farmers were kind, as they always are with young people. Even the most uncommunicative would grunt, "I see you've got to apprentice with you," as we got out of the car. But those farmers had something which Jimmy coveted, their big hobnailed boots. He had a great admiration for farmers in general, strong, hardy men who spent their lives in the open, and who pushed fearlessly among plunging packs of cattle and slapped the rumps of massive cart horses. I could see he was deeply impressed as he watched them, quite often small and stringy, mounting granary steps with 12 or 16 stone sacks on their shoulders, or hanging on effortlessly to the noses of huge bullocks, their boots slithering over the floor, a laconic cigarette hanging from their lips. It was those boots which got under Jimmy's skin most of all. Sturdy and unyielding, they seemed to symbolise for him the characters of the men who wore them. Matters came to a head one day when we were conversing in the car. Or rather, my son was doing the conversing in the form of a barrage of questions which I did my best to fend off while trying to think about my cases. These questions went on pretty well non-stop every day, and they followed a well-tried formula. "What is the fastest train, the Blue Peter or the Flying Scotsman?" "Well, now, I really don't know. I should say the Blue Peter." Then, getting into deeper water, "Is a giant train faster than a phantom racing car?" "Well, that's a difficult one. Let's see now. Maybe the Phantom Racer." Jimmy changed the tack suddenly. "That was a big man at the Flass Farm, wasn't he?"
"He certainly was."
"Was he bigger than Mr. Robinson?"
We were launching into his favourite big man game, and I knew how it would end, but I played my part.
"Oh, yes, he was." "Was he bigger than Mr. Leeming?"
"Certainly."
"Was he bigger than Mr. Kirkley?"
"Without a doubt."
Jimmy gave me a sidelong glance, and I knew he was about to play his two trump cards. "Was he bigger than the gas man?"
The towering gentleman who came to read the gas meters at Skeldale House had always fascinated my son, and I had to think very carefully over my reply.
"Well, you know, I really think he was."
"Ah, but..."
The corner of Jimmy's mouth twitched up craftily. "Was he bigger than Mr. Thackeray?"
That was the killer punch. Nobody was bigger than Mr. Thackeray, who looked down on the other inhabitants of Darrowby from 6 feet 7 inches. I shrugged my shoulders in defeat. "No, I have to admit it, he wasn't as big as Mr. Thackeray." Jimmy smiled and nodded, well satisfied. Then he began to hum a little tune, drumming his fingers on the dashboard at the same time. Soon I could see he was having trouble. He couldn't remember how it went. Patience was not his strong point, and as he tried and stopped again and again, it was plain that he was rapidly becoming exasperated. Finally, as we drove down a steep hill into a village and another abortive session of tumpty-tumpty-tum came to an abrupt halt, he rounded on me aggressively.
"You know," he exploded, "I'm getting just about fed up of this."
"I'm sorry to hear that, old lad," I thought for a moment.
"I think it's Lillibullero you're trying to get."
I gave a swift rendering.
"Yes, that's it."
He slapped his knee and bawled out the melody at the top of his voice several times in triumph.
This put him in such high good humour that he broached something which must have been on his mind for some time. "Daddy," he said, "can I have some boots?"
"Boots? But you've got some already, haven't you?" I pointed down at the little Wellingtons in which Helen always rigged him before he set out for the farms. He gazed at his feet sadly before replying, "Yes, I know, but I want proper boots like the farmers." This was a facer. I didn't know what to say. "But, Jim, little boys like you don't have boots like that. Maybe when you're bigger." "Oh, I want them now," he moaned in anguished tones. "I want proper boots." At first, I thought it was a passing whim, but he kept up his campaign for several days, reinforcing it with disgusted looks as Helen drew on the Wellingtons each morning, and a listless slouching to convey the message that his footwear was entirely unsuitable for a man like him. Finally, Helen and I talked it over one night after he'd gone to bed. "They surely don't have farm boots his size, do they?" I asked. Helen shook her head. "I wouldn't have thought so, but I'll look around in any case." And it seemed that Jimmy wasn't the only little boy to have this idea, because within a week my wife returned, flushed with success and bearing the smallest pair of farm boots I had ever seen. I couldn't help laughing. They were so tiny, yet so perfect. Thick, hobnailed soles, chunky uppers, and a long row of lace holes with metal loops at the top. Jimmy didn't laugh when he saw them. He handled them almost with awe, and once he had got them on, his demeanour changed. He was naturally square-set and jaunty, but to see him striding round a farmyard in corduroy leggings and those boots, you would think he owned the place. He clumped and stamped, held himself very upright, and his cries of, "Hello! Hello!" took on a new authority. It was never what I would call naughty, certainly never destructive or cruel, but he had that bit of devil which I suppose all boys need to have. He liked to assert himself, and perhaps unconsciously he liked to tease me. If I said, "Don't touch that," he would keep clear of the object in question. But later, he would give it the merest brush with his finger, which could not be construed as disobedience, but nevertheless served to establish his influence in the household. Also, he was not above taking advantage of me in awkward situations. There was one afternoon when Mr. Garrett brought his sheepdog in. The animal was very lame, and as I hoisted him onto the table in the consulting room, a small head appeared for a moment at the window which overlooked the sunlit garden. Well, I didn't mind that. Jimmy often watched me dealing with our small animal patients, and I half expected him to come into the room for a closer look. It is often difficult to locate the source of a dog's lameness, but in this case, I found it immediately. When I gently squeezed the outside pad on his left foot, he winced, and a tiny bead of serum appeared on the black surface. "He's got something in there, Mr. Garrett," I said. "Probably a thorn. I'll have to give him a shot of local anaesthetic and open up his pad." It was when I was filling the syringes that a knee came into view at the corner of the window. I felt a pang of annoyance. Jimmy surely couldn't be climbing up the wisteria. It was dangerous, and I had expressly forbidden it. The branches of the beautiful creeper curled all over the back of the house, and though they were as thick as a man's leg near ground level, they became quite slender as they made their way up past the bathroom window to the tiles of the roof. No. I decided that I was mistaken and began to infiltrate the pad. These modern anaesthetics worked very quickly, and within a minute or two I could squeeze the area quite hard without causing pain. I reached for the scalpel. "Hold his leg up and keep it as steady as you can," I said. Mr. Garrett nodded and pursed his lips. He was a serious-faced man at any time, and obviously deeply concerned about his dog. His eyes narrowed in apprehension as I poised my knife over the telltale drop of moisture. For me, it was an absorbing moment. If I could find and remove this foreign body, the dog would be instantly rid of his pain. I had dealt with many of these cases in the past, and they were so easy, so satisfying. With the point of my blade, I made a careful nick in the tough tissue of the pad, and at that moment a shadow crossed the window. I glanced up. It was Jimmy, all right, this time at the other side, just his head grinning through the glass from halfway up. The little blighter was on the wisteria. But there was nothing I could do about it then except to give him a quick glare. I cut a little deeper and squeezed, but still nothing showed in the wound. I didn't want to make a big hole, but it was clear that I had to make a cruciate incision to see further down. I was drawing the scalpel across at right angles to my first cut, when from the corner of my eye I spotted 2 feet dangling just below the top of the window. I tried to concentrate on my job, but the feet swung and kicked repeatedly, obviously for my benefit. At last, they disappeared, which could only mean that their owner was ascending to the dangerous regions. I dug down a little deeper and swabbed with cotton wool. Ah, yes, I could see something now, but it was very deep. Probably the tip of a thorn which had broken off well below the surface. I felt the thrill of the hunter as I reached for forceps, and just then the head showed itself again, upside down this time. My God, he was hanging by his feet from the branches, and the face was positively leering. In deference to my client, I had been trying to ignore the byplay from outside, but this was too much. I leapt at the glass and shook my fist violently. My fury must have startled the performer because the face vanished instantly, and I could hear faint sounds of feet scrambling upwards. That was not much comfort either. Those top branches might not support a boy's weight. I forced myself back to my task. "Sorry, Mr. Garrett," I said. "Will you hold the leg up again, please?" He replied with a thin smile, and I pushed my forceps into the depths. They grated on something hard. I gripped, pulled gently, and, oh, lovely, lovely, out came the pointed, glistening head of a thorn. I had done it. It was one of the tiny triumphs which lighten vets' lives, and I was beaming at my client and patting the dog's head when I heard the crack from above. It was followed by a long howl of terror, then a small form hurtled past the window and thudded with horrid force into the garden. I threw down the forceps and shot out of the room, along the passage and through the side door into the garden. Jimmy was already sitting up among the wallflowers, and I was too relieved to be angry. "Have you hurt yourself?" I gasped, and he shook his head. I lifted him to his feet, and he seemed to be able to stand all right. I felt him over carefully. There appeared to be no damage. I led him back into the house. "Go along and see Mummy," I said, and returned to the consulting room. I must have been deathly pale when I entered, because Mr. Garrett looked startled. "Is he all right?" he asked. "Yes, yes, I think so. But I do apologise for rushing out like that. It was really too bad of me to..." Mr. Garrett laid his hand on my shoulder. "Say no more, Mr. Herriot. I have children of my own." And then he spoke the words which have become engraven on my heart. "You need nerves of steel to be a parent." Later at tea, I watched my son demolishing a poached egg on toast, and then he started to slap plum jam on a slice of bread. Thank heaven he was no worse for his fall, but I still had to remonstrate with him. "Look, young man," I said, "that was a very naughty thing you did out there. I've told you again and again not to climb the wisteria." Jimmy bit into his bread and jam and regarded me impassively. I have a big streak of old hen in my nature, and down through the years, even to this day, he and later my daughter Rosie have recognised this and developed a disconcerting habit of making irreverent clucking noises at my over-fussiness. At this moment, I could see that whatever I was going to say, he wasn't going to take it too seriously. "If you're going to behave like this," I went on, "I'm not going to take you round the farms with me. I'll just have to find another little boy to help me with my cases." His chewing slowed down, and I looked for some reaction in this morsel of humanity, who was later to become a far better veterinary surgeon than I could ever be. In fact, to quote 30 years later, a dry Scottish colleague who had been through college with me and didn't mince words, "A hell of an improvement on his old man." Jimmy dropped the bread on his plate. "Another little boy?" he inquired. "That's right. I can't have naughty boys with me. I'll have to find somebody else." Jimmy thought this over for a minute or so. Then he shrugged and appeared to accept the situation philosophically. He started again on his bread and jam. Then in a flash, his sang-froid evaporated. He stopped in mid-chew and looked at me in wide-eyed alarm. His voice came out in a high quaver. "Would he have my boots?"
Thank you.
Chapter 6.
By gore, it's Dr. Fu Manchu!
The farmer dropped the buttered scone onto his plate and stared horror-struck through the kitchen window. I was drinking a cup of tea with him, and I almost choked in mid-sip as I followed his gaze. Beyond the glass, an enormous Oriental was standing. Slit eyes regarded us menacingly from a pockmarked face, whose left cheek was hideously scarred from ear to chin, but the most arresting feature was the one-sided mustachio, black and greasy with its single end dangling several inches from the upper lip. A robe of exotic colouring flowed from the man's shoulders, and his hands, held across his body, were tucked deeply into the sleeves. The farmer's wife screamed and jumped from the table, but I sat transfixed. I couldn't believe this apparition, framed as it was against the buildings and pastures of a Yorkshire farm. The wife's rising screams were bordering on hysteria when suddenly she stopped and advanced slowly to the window. As she came close, the big man's mouth relaxed into a friendly leer. Then he withdrew a hand from the sleeve and waggled the fingers at her, in Oliver Hardy fashion. "It's Igor," she gasped, and swung round on her husband.
"And that's me good house coat he's got on.
You rotten devil! You put him up to this!"
The farmer rolled about in his chair, laughing helplessly. He couldn't have asked for a better response to his little joke. Igor was one of the batch of prisoners of war who had recently arrived to work on the farm. There were hundreds of these men employed on the land at the end of the war, and it was a happy arrangement all round. The farmers had a windfall in the shape of abundant labour, and the prisoners were content to spend their pre-repatriation time in the open air with ample farm meals to sustain them in a world of food rationing. I personally had a respite from one of my constant problems, the lack of help in my job. I found now that there were always willing hands to assist me in the rough and tumble of large animal practice. The prisoners were, of course, mainly German, but there were a number of Italians, and, strangely, Russians. It baffled me at first when I saw hundreds of men who looked like Chinese in German uniforms disembarking at Darabi railway station. I learned later that they were Mongolian Russians who had been pressed into fighting for the Germans and later were captured by the British. Igor was one of these. I know of farming families who to this day spend their holidays at the homes of Germans and Italians whom they befriended at this time. I was still laughing after the Igor incident, and the farmer was still receiving a tongue-lashing from his wife, when I climbed into my car and consulted the list of calls. "Preston, Scarth Lodge, Lame Cow," I read. It was 20 minutes' drive away, and as always I idly turned over the possibilities in my mind. Probably foul. Maybe pus in the foot, which would entail some hacking with my hoof knife. Or it could be a strain. I'd soon see. Hal Preston was bringing my patient in from the fields as I arrived, and I didn't even have to get out of my car to make my diagnosis. It was one which gave me no joy. The cow was hobbling slowly with her right hind foot barely touching the ground. The limb was shortened and carried underneath the body, while a bulge in the pelvic region showed where the great trochanter of the femur pushed against the skin. Upward displacement. Absolutely typical. "Just happened this morning," farmer said. "She was as right as rain last night." "I can't think." "Say no more, Mr. Preston," I said. "I know what it is. She's got a dislocated hip."
"Is that serious?"
"Yes, it is. You see, it takes tremendous force to pull the head of the displaced bone back into its socket. Even in a dog it's a difficult job, but in cattle it's sometimes impossible." The farmer looked glum.
"Well, that's a beggar. This is a right good cow, smashing milker. What happens if you can't get it back?"
"I'm afraid she'll always be a bit of a cripple," I replied. "Dogs usually form a very good false joint, but it's different with a cow. In fact, many farmers decide to slaughter the animal."
"Oh, well, I don't want that."
Hal Preston rubbed his chin vigorously.
"We'll have to have a go."
"Good. That's what I want." I turned towards my car. "I'm going back to the surgery for the chloroform muzzle, and in the meantime, will you go round your neighbours and get a few strong chaps? We'll need all the manpower you can find." The farmer looked round the rolling green miles with not another dwelling in sight.
"Me neighbours are a long way away. But I don't need them today. Look here."
He led the way into the farm kitchen where the savoury aroma of roast bacon was heavy in the air. 4 burly Germans were seated at the table. In front of each lay a plate mounded high with potatoes, cabbage, bacon and sausage.
"They sent me these fellas to help with A-time," Mr. Preston explained.
I reckon they look pretty useful.
They do indeed. I smiled at the men and waved my hand in greeting. They jumped to their feet and bowed.
Right, I said to the farmer, you can be having your dinners while I'm gone. I'll be back in about half an hour.
When I returned, we led the cow to a patch of soft grass. Her progress was painfully slow as she trailed her almost useless hind leg. I buckled the muzzle to her head and dribbled the chloroform onto the sponge. As she inhaled the strange vapour, her eyes widened in surprise. Then she stumbled forward and sank to the turf. I slipped a round stake into the animal's groin and stationed the two biggest men at either end of it. Then I fastened the rope above the fetlock and gave the other end to Mr. Preston and the remaining two Germans. The stage was set. I crouched over the pelvis and placed both hands on the bulging head of the femur. Would it stay obstinately still, or would I feel it riding up the side of the acetabulum on the way to its proper home? Anyway, this was the moment, and I took a deep breath.
Pull! I shouted. And the three men on the rope hauled away while the brown, corded arms on each side of me took the strain on the stake. No doubt an unedifying spectacle, this tug of war with a sleeping animal in the middle. Not much science in evidence, but country practice is often like that. However, I had no time for theorising. All my mind was concentrated on that jutting bone under my hands.
Pull!
I yelled again, and fresh grunts of effort came back in reply. I clenched my teeth. The thing wasn't moving. I couldn't believe it could resist such terrific traction, but it was like a rock. Then, when the feeling of defeat was rising, I felt a stirring beneath my fingers. It all happened in seconds after that. The lifting of the femoral head as I pushed frantically at it, and the loud click as it flopped into its socket. We had won. I waved my arms in delight.
All right, let go.
I crawled to the cow's head and whipped off the muzzle. We heaved her onto her chest and she lay there, blinking and shaking her head as consciousness returned. I could hardly wait for what is one of the most rewarding moments in veterinary practice. And it came when the cow rose to her feet and strolled over the grass without the trace of a limp. The five faces, sweating in the hot sunshine, watched in happy amazement. And though I had seen it all before, I felt the warm flush of triumph which is always new. I handed cigarettes round to the prisoners, and before I left, I drew on my scanty store of German.
Dankeschön,
I said fervently. And I really meant it.
Bitte, bitte,
they cried, all smiles. They had enjoyed the whole thing, and I had the feeling that this would be one of the tales they would tell when they returned to their homes. A few days later, Siegfried and I alighted at Village Farm, Harford. We had come together because we had been told that our patient, a red poll bullock, was of an uncooperative disposition, and we thought that a combined operation was indicated. The farmer led us to the fold yard where about 20 cattle were eating turnips.
That's the one,
he said, pointing to an enormously fat beast.
And that's the thing I was telling you about.
He indicated a growth as big as a football dangling from the animal's belly. Siegfried gave him a hard look. Really, Mr. Harrison, you should have called us out to this long ago. Why did you let it get so big? The farmer took off his hat and scratched his balding head ruminatively.
Ah, well, you know how it is. I kept meaning to give you a ring, but it slipped me mind and time went on.
It's a hell of a size now, Siegfried grunted.
I know, I know. I always had the hope that it might drop off because he's a right wild sod. You can't do much with him.
All right, then, Siegfried shrugged. Bring a halter and we'll drive him into that box over there. The farmer left and my partner turned to me. You know, James, that tumour isn't as fearsome as it looks. It's beautifully pedunculated, and if we can get a shot of local into that narrow neck, we can ligate it and have it off in no time. The farmer returned with the halter, and he was accompanied by a dark little man in denims.
This is Luigi, he said. Italian prisoner. Don't speak no English, but he's very handy at all sorts of jobs.
I can imagine Luigi being handy. He was short in stature, but his wide spread of shoulder and muscular arms suggested great strength. We said hello, and the Italian returned our greetings with an inclination of his head and a grave smile. He carried an aura of dignity and self-assurance. After a bit of galloping round the fold yard, we managed to get our patient into the box, but we soon realised that our troubles were only beginning. Red polls are big cattle, and an ill-natured one can be a problem. This fat creature had a mean look in his eyes, and all our attempts to halter him were unavailing. He either whipped away from the rope or shook his head threateningly at us. Once, as he thundered past me, I put my fingers into his nose, but he brushed me off like a fly and lashed out with a hind leg, catching me a glancing blow on the thigh. "God, he's like an elephant," I gasped. "God only knows how we're going to catch him." The sedative injections for such animals and the metal crushes to restrain them were still years in the future, and Siegfried and I were looking gloomily at the bullock when Luigi stepped forward. He held up a hand and loosed off a burst of Italian at us. None of us could understand him, but we took his point as he ushered us back against the wall with great ceremony. Plainly he was going to do something. But what? He advanced stealthily on the bullock. Then, with a lightning movement, he seized one of the ears in both hands. The animal took off immediately, but without its previous abandon. Luigi was screwing the ear round on its long axis, and it seemed to act as a brake because the beast slowed to a halt and stood there, head on one side, glancing almost plaintively up at the little man. I was reminded irresistibly of pictures of Billy Bunter being held by a Greyfriars prefect, and I almost expected the bullock to cry, "Ouch! Yaroo! Leggo my ear!" But I didn't have much time for musing, because Luigi, in full command of the situation, jerked his head towards the hanging tumour. Siegfried and I leapt forward. We had never seen anybody catch a beast by the ear before, but we weren't going to discuss it. This was our chance. I cradled the growth in my hands while Siegfried injected the local into the neck. As the needle entered the skin, the hairy leg twitched, and under ordinary circumstances we would have been kicked out of the box, but Luigi took another half-turn on the ear and rapped out a colourful reprimand. The animal subsided immediately and stood motionless as we worked. Siegfried applied a strong ligature and severed the neck bloodlessly with an écrasure. The tumour thudded onto the straw. The operation was over. Luigi released the ear and received our congratulations with a half-smile and a gracious nodding of the head. He really was a man of enormous presence. Now, more than 30 years later, Siegfried and I still talk about him. We have both tried to catch large cattle by the ears without the slightest success. So was Luigi just an amateur with wrists of steel, or was he a farmer? And do they do it that way in Italy after a lifetime of practice? We still don't know. One still summer evening, I was returning from a call when I heard the sound of singing. It was a rich, swelling chorus of many voices, and it seemed to come from nowhere. I stopped the car and wound down the window. The fells rose around me, their summits glinting in the last sunshine, but the only living creatures were the cattle and sheep grazing on the walled slopes. Then I saw Knoll Manor perched on a plateau high above, and I remembered that hundreds of Russian prisoners were billeted there. These men were singing the songs of their homeland, but the sound which drifted from the windows of the big house was not that of a casual party. There was a vast, drilled choir up there, deep voices blending in thrilling harmonies which hung and lingered on the soft air. I sat entranced for a long time till the light faded, and the chill of nightfall made me close my window and drive away. Years later, I read that these Russians went home to death or captivity. And whenever I thought of their fate, I remembered that summer evening and the beautiful music they made in the peace of the Yorkshire hills. Chapter 7. October the 29th, 1961.
Breakfast, Mr. Herriot?
I heard the mess boy's call and his knock on my cabin door. It was the first of many during this day.
Lunch, Mr. Herriot? Dinner, Mr. Herriot? Coffee time, Mr. Herriot?
He was a fresh-faced lad of 17 and took care I didn't miss anything. I hurried to the mess room. To my surprise, I found it was empty, but there was a large pot of coffee on the table along with a stack of rye bread and a remarkable selection of cold meats and fish. I counted 9 different platters on the table. Well, it was an unusual breakfast, but I was hungry, so I started operations immediately. The coffee was delicious, and I was happily washing down wonderful raw herrings and onion, smoked ham, and a particularly toothsome meatloaf, when the mess boy appeared and smilingly deposited 2 fried eggs and bacon in front of me. I was surprised, but undeterred,
and as I started my fresh attack with the ship heaving and pitching, I thanked Providence that I had never known seasickness. I was soon joined by two of the ship's officers, the mate, a tubby little man, also called Rasmussen, and the engineer, Hansen, very dark with a humorous face. Neither of them spoke much English, but we managed to converse on various subjects, including football pools, which, when they had the chance, they both filled up assiduously without success. After breakfast, I went down to inspect my animals. The general picture was a happy one, but I noticed the sheep limping as it walked to its hay. I examined the feet and found a small area of foot rot. I had been told that the Russian vets were meticulous in their examination, but they had missed that one. I directed a long jet of terramycin aerosol at the affected spot. I was confident that a few more similar treatments would put that right before we reached Clydida. Another animal blinked painfully at me as I passed its pen, and I found that its eyes were weeping and inflamed. It was the only one so affected, and I felt that it had probably picked up some irritant material on the journey to Hull. I squeezed some chloramphenicol eye ointment across the eyeballs and decided to do the same at midday and in the evening. I finished my tour with the comforting thought that so far my stock of drugs had been adequate. Before lunch, the captain asked me to drink a glass of lager with him in his cabin. He himself, despite being a man of natural refinement, drank straight from the bottle, and later that day I found that this was the approved method among the ship's officers, but he gave me a glass. I sat down at the end of the table and poured the lager, and at that moment the ship gave a tremendous roll. My chair went over. I literally flew through the air, shot across the floor on my side, and finished up underneath a desk in the corner. My glass was shattered, and a pool of the precious Carlsberg special spread across the floor. The captain leapt anxiously to my assistance. "Oh, Mr. Herriot, I hope you do not hurt yourself." As I've said, his English was very good, but occasionally little inaccuracies crept in. "No, I'm fine," I replied, laughing. I got up and started on another bottle, but this time I kept my knees jammed against the legs of the table. I was beginning to learn. After this little contretemps, we went down to lunch, passing on the way the cook's galley. This was about the size of a large cupboard and was crammed with pans, stove, ovens, and food. I wondered how anybody could possibly produce proper meals in that tiny place, and it occurred to me that perhaps that was the reason for the lavish breakfast. The other meals would probably be makeshift, and I mentally resigned myself to the fact that I would have to put up with a primitive diet during the voyage. When we had gathered round the table in the little mess room, the first course arrived. It was an exquisite asparagus soup, in which floated meatballs and large stalks of asparagus. This was followed by what the captain described as boneless birds, tender veal steaks wrapped around strips of bacon, parsley and spices, with anchovies draped across them. We finished off with a sago pudding thickly sprinkled with cinnamon, and with peaches nestling on its bosom. As I sipped my coffee and nibbled delicious Danish cheese, I felt I might have been eating at the Ritz. The cook, Nielsen by name, a large, smiling man in a white apron, pushed his head round the door at the end of the meal, and I called out to him that his food was wonderful. He looked intensely gratified, but also surprised, because the other ship's officers seemed to take it all for granted. His smile grew wider, and he nodded his head rapidly. "Thank you, thank you, thank you." He stared at me as though he had been looking for me all his life. I had a feeling that I had made a friend there. After lunch, back down to tween decks and lower hold, to give them their proper names, for another look at the sheep. But on the way, I had to stop for a few minutes on the upper deck to take gulping breaths of the unbelievably fresh air that swept over the heaving miles of water. Walking around was difficult, as I found it almost impossible to stand upright because of the constant movement of the ship. Down below, I studied the animals carefully. There was something on my mind. Right at the beginning, I had heard the odd cough, and I hadn't paid much attention because all sheep cough occasionally. But since we sailed, it had become more frequent and had a rasping quality which was only too familiar. As I walked around, I heard it again, and this time I traced it to the affected sheep. I climbed into the pen, all Lincolns, and began to stir them around. And after a few seconds, there was a regular chorus of coughs. I knew now. They had husk. I took a few temperatures, leaning back against the swaying wall to read the thermometer. but there was clearly no secondary infection. It was a straightforward parasitic bronchitis, and with my pitiful little stock of drugs in the suitcase upstairs, there was nothing I could do about it. Of course, as I wrote my notes later in my cabin, I realised it was only a mild attack, and since they were off the pasture in top condition and with an abundant supply of good food, they would certainly throw it off in time. But for all that, I didn't like it. The vets in Hull didn't spot it, but those in Clydeder probably would, and I wanted to present a batch of healthy animals to them. Later, I had a most interesting hour with the captain on the bridge. He showed me how the radar and other gadgets worked and pointed out our position on the chart. We were off the coast of Holland, but out of sight of land. I was intrigued by the mariner's view of a map. The sea is a complicated mass of lines, words and figures, while the land is a white blank. At 6:30 p.m. I began again on what I had thought was to be my frugal living. Mountains of roast chicken with a pecan stuffing I had never tasted before, and surrounded by thin layers of cucumber done up with sugar and vinegar. Fruit followed, and of course there was the ever-present array of herrings and tomato, salami, salt beef, pork, smoked ham, bacon, and endless kinds of Danish sliced sausages and cheeses. I haven't mentioned the two most popular things among the Danes themselves, the liver paste and trays of dripping. The ship's officers seemed to love these two things, especially the dripping which they spread on rye bread and ate at the end of a meal. After dinner, we settled down to a two-hour session of smoking and swapping yarns over the schnapps and beer. I gather that this was a regular custom in the evenings. The seamen were very interesting with their tales of many countries and peoples, and the often startling adventures they had had on their travels. Chapter 8. It was Hemingway who said that, wasn't it? Norman Beaumont shook his head. No. Scott Fitzgerald. I didn't argue because Norman usually knew. In fact, it was one of the attractive things about him. I enjoyed having veterinary students seeing practice with us. They helped with fetching and carrying, they opened gates, and they were company on our lonely rounds. In return, they absorbed a lot of knowledge from us in our discussions in the car, and it was priceless experience for them to be involved in the practical side of their education. Since the war, however, my relationship with these young men had undergone a distinct change. I found I was learning from them just about as much as they were learning from me. The reason, of course, was that veterinary teaching had taken a leap forward. The authorities seemed to have suddenly discovered that we weren't just horse doctors, and that the vast new field of small animal work was opening up dramatically. Advanced surgical procedures were being carried out on farm animals, too, and the students had the great advantage of being able to see such things done in the new veterinary schools with their modern clinics and operating theatres. New specialist textbooks were being written, which made my own thumbed volumes with everything related to the horse seem like museum pieces. I was still a young man, but all the bursting knowledge which I had nurtured so proudly was becoming irrelevant. Quitter, fistulous withers, poll evil, bog spavin, string halt. They didn't seem to matter much anymore. Norman Beaumont was in his final year and was a deep well of information at which I drank greedily. But apart from the veterinary side, we had a common love of books and reading. When we weren't talking shop, the conversation was usually on literary lines, and Norman's companionship lightened my days and made the journeys between farms seem short. He was immensely likable, with a personality that was formal and dignified beyond his 22 years, and which was only just saved from pomposity by a gentle humour. He was a solid citizen in the making if ever I saw one, and this impression was strengthened by his slightly pear-shaped physique and the fact that he was determinedly trying to cultivate a pipe. He was having a little trouble with the pipe, but I felt sure he would win through. I could see him plainly 20 years from now, definitely tubby, sitting around the fireside with his wife and children, puffing at that pipe which he had finally subjugated, an upright, dependable family man with a prosperous practice. As the dry stone walls rolled past the car windows, I got back onto the topic of the new operations. "And you say they are actually doing caesareans on cows in the college clinics?"
"Good Lord, yes!"
Norman made an expansive gesture and applied a match to his pipe.
"Doing them like hotcakes. It's a regular thing."
His words would have carried more weight if he'd been able to blow a puff of smoke out after them, but he had filled the bowl too tightly, and despite a fierce sucking which hollowed his cheeks and ballooned his eyeballs, he couldn't manage a draw. "Gosh, you don't know how lucky you are," I said. "The number of hours I've slaved on byre floors carving cows, sewing up calves with embryotomy wire, knocking my guts out trying to bring heads round or reach feet. I think I must have shortened my life. And if I'd only known how, I could have saved myself the trouble with a nice, straightforward operation. What sort of job is it, anyway?" The student gave me a superior smile. "Nothing much to it, really." He relit his pipe, tamped the tobacco down, and winced as he burnt his finger. He shook his hand vigorously for a moment, then turned towards me. "They never seem to have any trouble. Takes about an hour, and no hard labour." "God, sounds marvellous." I shook my head wistfully. "I'm beginning to think I was born too soon." "I suppose it's the same with ewes." "Oh, yes. Yes, indeed," Norman murmured airily. "Ewes, cows, sows. They're in and out of the place every day. No problem at all. Nearly as easy as bitch spays. Ah, well, you young lads are lucky. It's so much easier to tackle these jobs when you've seen a lot of them done." "True, true," the student spread his hands. "But of course most bovine parturitions don't need a caesarean, and I'm always glad to have a carving for my casebook." I nodded in agreement. Norman's casebook was something to see. A heavily bound volume with every scrap of interesting material meticulously entered under headings in red ink. The examiners always wanted to see these books, and this one would be worth a few extra marks to Norman in his finals. It was August Bank Holiday Sunday, and Darraby Marketplace had been bustling all day with holidaymakers and coach parties. Each time we passed through, I looked at the laughing throngs with a tiny twinge of envy. Not many people seem to work on Sundays. I dropped the student at his digs in late afternoon and went back to Skeldale House for tea. I had just finished when Helen got up to answer the phone. "It's Mr. Bushell of Sycamore House," she said. "He has a cow carving." "Oh, damn. I thought we'd have Sunday evening to ourselves." I put down my cup. "Tell him I'll be right out, Helen, will you?" I smiled as she put down the receiver. "One thing. Norman will be pleased. He was just saying he wanted something for his casebook." I was right. The young man rubbed his hands in glee when I called for him, and he was in excellent humour as we drove to the farm. "I was reading some poetry when you rang the bell," he said. "I like poetry. You can always find something to apply to your life. How about now, when I'm expecting something interesting? Hope springs eternal in the human breast?" "Alexander Pope, Essay on Man," I grunted. I wasn't feeling as enthusiastic as Norman. You never knew what was ahead on these occasions. "Jolly good," the young man laughed. "You aren't easy to catch out." We drove through the farm gateway into the yard. "You've made me think with your poetry," I said. "It keeps buzzing in my head. Abandon hope, all ye who enter here. Dante, of course, the Inferno. But don't be so pessimistic." He patted me on the shoulder as I put on my Wellingtons. The farmer led us into the byre, and in a stall opposite the window a small cow looked up at us anxiously from her straw bed. Above her head, her name Bella was chalked on a board. "She isn't very big, Mr. Bushell," I said. "Eh?" He looked at me inquiringly, and I remembered that he was hard of hearing.
"She's a bit small," I shouted.
The farmer shrugged.
"Ah, she always was a poor doer. Had a rough time with her first calving, but she milked well enough after it."
I looked thoughtfully at the cow as I stripped off my shirt and soaked my arms. I didn't like the look of that narrow pelvis, and I breathed the silent prayer of all vets that there might be a tiny calf inside. The farmer poked at the light roan hairs of the rump with his foot and shouted at the animal to make a rise.
"She won't budge, Mr. Herriot," he said. "She's been paining all day. I doubt she's about buggered."
I didn't like the sound of that either. There was always something far wrong when a cow strained for a long time without result. And the little animal did look utterly spent. Her head hung down and her eyelids drooped wearily. Oh, well, if she wouldn't get up, I had to get down. With my bare chest in contact with the ground, the thought occurred that cobbles didn't get any softer with the passage of the years. But when I slid my hand into the vagina, I forgot about my discomfort. The pelvic opening was villainously narrow, and beyond was something which froze my blood. Two enormous hooves, and resting on their cloven surfaces a huge expanse of muzzle with twitching nostrils. I didn't have to feel any more, but with an extra effort I strained forward a few inches, and my fingers explored a bulging brow, squeezing into the small space like a cork in a bottle. As I withdrew my hand, the rough surface of the calf's tongue flicked briefly against my palm. I sat back on my heels and looked up at the farmer. There's an elephant in there, Mr. Bushel.
Eh?
I raised my voice.
A tremendous calf and no room for it to come out. Can't you cut it away? Afraid not. The calf's alive, and anyway, there's nothing to get at. No room to work.
Well, that's a beggar,
Mr. Bushel said.
She's a good little milker. I don't want to send her to the butcher.
Neither did I. I hated the very thought of it. But a great light was breaking beyond a new horizon. It was a moment of decision, of history. I turned to the student.
This is it, Norman, the ideal indication for a Caesar. What a good job I've got you with me. You can keep me right.
I was slightly breathless with excitement, and I hardly noticed the flicker of anxiety in the young man's eyes. I got to my feet and seized the farmer's arm.
Mr. Bushel! I'd like to do a caesarean operation on your cow.
A what?
A caesarean. Open her up and remove the calf surgically.
Take it out of the side, you mean? Like you do with women?
That's right.
Well, that's a rummun.
The farmer's eyebrows went up.
I never knew you could do that with cows.
Oh, we can now, I said airily. Things have moved on a bit in the last few years.
He rubbed a hand slowly across his mouth.
Well, I don't know. I reckon she'd die if you made a bloody great hole in her like that. Maybe she'd be better going for slaughter. I'll get a few quid for her, and I always think first lost is best.
I could see my big moment slipping away from me.
But she's only a thin little thing. She wouldn't be worth much for meat, and with a bit of luck we might get a live calf out of her.
I was going against one of my steadfast rules, never to talk a farmer into doing something, but I was seized by a kind of madness. Mr. Bushel looked at me for a long time, then without changing expression, he nodded.
All right. What do you want? 2 buckets of warm water, soap, towels,
I replied,
and I'll bring some instruments into the house to boil, if I may.
When the farmer had departed, I thumped Norman on the shoulder.
This is just right. Plenty of light. A live calf to aim for,
and it's just as well poor Mr. Bushel doesn't hear too well. If we keep our voices down, I'll be able to ask you things as we go along. Norman didn't say anything. I told him to set up some straw bales for our equipment and had him scatter loose straw around the cow while I boiled the instruments in a pan in the farm kitchen. Soon, all was ready. Syringes, suture materials, scalpels, scissors, local anaesthetic and cotton wool laid in a row on a clean towel draped over one of the bales. I added some antiseptic to the water and addressed the farmer.
We'll roll her over and you can hold her head down, Mr. Bushel. I think she's too tired to move much.
Norman and I pushed at the shoulder and Bella flopped on her side without resistance. The farmer put his knee against her neck and the long area of the left flank was exposed for our attention. I nudged the student.
Where do I make the incision?
I whispered. Norman cleared his throat. He pointed vaguely. I nodded. Around the ruminotomy site, eh? But a bit lower, I suppose. I began to clip away the hair from a foot-long strip. It would need a big opening for that calf to come through. Then I quickly infiltrated the area with local. We do these jobs under a local anaesthetic nowadays, and in most cases the cow lies quietly on her side or even stands during the operation. The animal can't feel anything, of course, but I have a few extra grey hairs round my ears which owe their presence to the occasional wild cow suddenly rearing up halfway through and taking off with me in desperate pursuit, trying to keep her internal organs from flopping on the ground. But that was all in the future. On this first occasion, I had no such fears. I cut through skin, muscle layers, and peritoneum, and was confronted by a protruding pink and white mass of tissue. I poked at it with my finger. There was something hard inside. Could it be the calf? "What's that?" I hissed. "Eh?" Norman, kneeling by my side, jumped convulsively. "What do you mean?" "That thing. Is it the rumen or the uterus?" "It's pretty low down. It could be the uterus." The student swallowed a couple of times. "Yes. Yes, that's the uterus, all right." "Good." I smiled in relief and made a bold incision. A great gout of impacted grass welled out, followed by a burst of gas and an outflow of dirty brown fluid. "Oh, Christ!" I gasped. "It's the rumen. Look at all that bloody mess." I groaned aloud as the filthy tide surged away, down and out of sight into the abdominal cavity. "What the hell are you playing at, Norman?" I could feel the young man's body trembling against mine. "Don't just sit there," I shouted. "Throw me one of those needles, quick, quick!" Norman bounded to his feet, rushed over to the bale and returned with a trailing length of catgut extended in shaking fingers. Wordlessly, dry-mouthed, I stitched the gash I had made in the wrong organ. Then the two of us made frantic attempts to swab away the escaped ruminal contents with cotton wool and antiseptic, but much of it had run away beyond our reach. The contamination must be massive. When we had done what we could, I sat back and looked at the student. My voice was a hoarse growl. "I thought you knew all about these operations." He looked at me with frightened eyes. "They do quite a few of them at the clinic." I glared back at him. "How many caesareans have you seen?" "Well, one, actually." "One? To hear you speak, I thought you were an expert. And anyway, even if you'd only seen one, you should know a little bit about it." "The thing is," Norman shuffled his knees around on the cobbles, "you see, I was right at the back of the class." I worked up a sarcastic snarl. "Oh, I understand. So you couldn't see very well." "That's about it." The young man hung his head. "Well, you're a stupid young fool," I said in a vicious whisper. "Dishing out your confident instructions when you know damn all. You realise you've killed this good cow? With all that contamination, she'll certainly develop peritonitis and die. All we can hope for now is to get the calf out alive." With an effort, I turned my gaze from his stricken face. "Anyway, let's get on with it." Apart from my first shouts of panic, the entire interchange had been carried out pianissimo, and Mr. Bushell kept shooting inquiring glances at us. I gave him what I hoped was a reassuring smile and returned to the attack. Getting the calf out alive was easy to say. But it soon dawned on me that getting the calf out in any way whatsoever was going to be a mammoth task. Plunging my arm deep below what I now knew was the rumen, I encountered a smooth and mighty organ lying on the abdominal floor. It contained an enormous bulk with the hardness and immobility of a sack of coal. I felt my way along the surface and came upon the unmistakable contours of a hock pushing against the slippery wall. That was the calf, all right. But it was far, far away. I withdrew my arm and started on Norman again. "From your position at the back of the class," I inquired bitingly, "did you happen to notice what they did next?" "Next? Ah, yes." He licked his lips and I could see beads of sweat on his brow. "You are supposed to exteriorize the uterus." "Exteriorize it? Bring it up to the wound, you mean?" "That's right." "Good God," I said. "King Kong couldn't lift up that bloody uterus. In fact, I can't move it an inch. Have a feel." The student, who was stripped and soaped like myself, introduced his arm, and for a few moments I watched his eyes pop and his face redden. Then he withdrew and nodded sheepishly. "You're right. It won't move." "Only one thing to do." I picked up a scalpel. "I'll have to cut into the uterus and grab that hock. There's nothing else to get hold of." It was very nasty fiddling about away out of sight down in the dark unknown. my arm buried to the shoulder in the cow, my tongue hanging out with anxiety. I was terrified I might slash into something vital. But in fact, it was my own fingers that I cut several times before I was able to draw the scalpel edge across the bulge made by the hawk. A second later, I had my hand round the hairy leg. Now I was getting somewhere. Gingerly, I enlarged the incision inch by inch. I hoped fervently I'd made it big enough, but working blind is a terrible thing, and it was difficult to be sure. At any rate, I couldn't wait to deliver that calf. I laid aside my knife, seized the leg, and tried to lift it, and immediately I knew that another little nightmare lay ahead. The thing was a tremendous weight, and it was going to take great strength to bring it out into the light of day. Nowadays, when I do a Caesar, I take care to have a big, strong farm lad stripped off ready to help me with this lifting job. But today, I had only Norman. "Come on," I panted. "Give me a hand." We reached down together and began to pull. I managed to repel the hawk and bring the foot round, and that gave us greater purchase, but it was still agonizingly laborious to raise the mass to the level of the skin incision. Teeth clenched, grunting with effort, we hauled upwards, till at last I was able to grasp the other hind leg. Even then, with a foot apiece in our hands, nothing wanted to move. It was just like doing a tough carving, except it was through the side. And as we lay back, panting and sweating, pulling with every vestige of our strength, I had the sudden wave of illumination which comes to all members of our profession at times. I wished with all my heart and soul that I had never started this ghastly job. If only I had followed Mr. Bushell's suggestion to send the cow for slaughter, I would now be driving peacefully on my rounds. Instead, here I was, killing myself. And even worse than my physical torment was the piercing knowledge that I hadn't the slightest idea what was going to happen next. But the calf was gradually coming through. The tail appeared. Then an unbelievably massive rib cage, and finally, with a rush, the shoulders and head. Norman and I sat down with a bump, the calf rolling over our knees. And, like a gleam of light in the darkness, I saw that he was snorting and shaking his head.
"By God, he's a big un!" exclaimed the farmer. "And wick, too!"
I nodded.
"Yes, he's huge. One of the biggest I've ever seen."
I felt between the hind legs.
"A bull, as I thought. He'd never have come out the proper way."
My attention was whisked back to the cow. Where was the uterus? It had vanished. Again I started my frantic groping inside. My hand became entangled with yards of placenta. Oh, hell! That wouldn't do any good, floating around among the guts. I pulled it out and dropped it on the floor. But I still couldn't find the uterus. For a palpitating moment, I wondered what would happen if I never did locate it. Then my fingers came upon the ragged edge of my incision. I pulled as much as possible of the organ up to the light, and I noticed with sinking disquiet that my original opening had been enlarged by the passage of that enormous calf, and there was a long tear disappearing out of sight towards the cervix.
Sutures!
I held my hand out, and Norman gave me a fresh needle. "Hold the lips of the wound," I said, and began to stitch. I worked as quickly as I could and was doing fine until the tear ran out of sight. The rest was a kind of martyrdom. Norman hung on grimly while I stabbed around at the invisible tissue far below. At times I pricked the young man's fingers, at others my own, and to my dismay a further complication had arisen. The calf was now on his feet, blundering unsteadily around. The speed with which newly born animals get onto their legs has always fascinated me, but at this moment it was an unmitigated nuisance. The calf, looking for the udder with that instinct which nobody can explain, kept pushing his nose at the cow's flank and at times toppling head first into the gaping hole in her side.
"Reckon he wants back in again," Mr. Bushell said with a grin. "By heck, he's a wick-un."
Wick is Yorkshire for lively, and the word was never more aptly applied. As I worked, eyes half-closed, jaws rigid, I had to keep nudging the wet muzzle away with my elbow. But as fast as I pushed him back, the calf charged in again, and with sick resignation I saw that every time he nosed his way into the cavity, he brought particles of straw and dirt from the floor and spread them over the abdominal contents. "Look at that," I moaned, "as if there wasn't enough muck in there." Norman didn't reply. His mouth was hanging open and the sweat ran down his blood-streaked face as he grappled with that unseen wound. And in his fixed stare, I seemed to read a growing doubt as to his wisdom in deciding to be a veterinary surgeon.
Thank you for listening to our audiobooks. We do our best to regularly upload quality books with clear narrations. Please subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell icon so we can bring you more great books. Thank you very much, and we hope you enjoyed listening to your audiobook.